2024, the month of May, Topher has the world against him. So I told you and our audiences a couple weeks ago that I had broken a crown in my mouth.
Yes.
Went to the dentist and got a replacement, and not a full replacement. It's temporary. So I have to go back in a few weeks and have the real one put in.
Okay.
Then, like a week later, I had the breathalyzer installed in the inside of my car due to my DUI. Don't drink. Yep. Kids and adults listening, don't drink and drive. Trust me.
Not worth it.
So I get that going. Friday morning, I wake up bright eyed in a good mood. I'm like, you know what? Today's gonna be a good day. I'm gonna get to work an hour early. It's gonna be awesome. Mm-hmm. I get out of my apartment complex and I'm at the red light right outside. Ding, ding, ding. My car pops up with an alert. I go, huh, what's this? It says flat tire. I go, no way. I just drove my car last night. I'm at the red light. I step out of my car and look at the back left tire, completely flat down to the rim.
What?
And it is about at 6:30 in the morning at this point. And so I go to the AAA website. And of course, now everything's digital. So you have to submit a request online for help, roadside assistance. After waiting for an hour and a half, I finally get a text from AAA. They say, hey, your driver will be there in 45 minutes. I go, oh my God, you got to be kidding me. So AAA guy shows up. He goes, well, first thing we got to do is try and put air in the tire. I go, trust me, it's not going to work. Sure enough, it doesn't work. He goes, all right, we're going to tow it. And for those of you who don't know how a breathalyzer in your car works, it's called the interlock system. You have to, before you start the car, you have to breathe into the interlock. It'll say your BAC is 0.000. You pass. Now your car can turn on. Boop. Okay. All right. We get it on the back of the truck bed and I get a tow to a tire center. We get to the tire center and I'm inside talking deets with the tire guy.
Mm-hmm.
And I had told the tow truck driver, I said, don't press start without me because I need to breathe into it. Otherwise, it's going to go haywire. What does he do? He turns on the car. And so we spent the next hour trying to get the car off the back of the truck bed. And, you know, I'm new to this thing and I hadn't had any, no one else has been in my car since I had the interlock installed. And so I was like, all right, look, turn it off. We're going to wait a couple minutes and then we'll try it again, but don't press the start button. He goes, okay. Mm-hmm. And I'm explaining all this also to the tire guy. And he goes, yeah, it won't be a problem. So, we finally get we wait for a while. I breathe into it. Then we start the car. We get the car off the truck bed and then we're waiting for tires. And the guy goes, yeah, it's going to be about 2.5-3 hours. And I tell him, I go, okay, listen, I have a breathalyzer thing in my car. I not only have to breathe into it before I start the car, but it gives random alerts if the car is on for me to continue to breathe into it.
Oh,
so
really?
if you need to turn the car back on, come get me. I'll breathe into it. And then you can continue working. He goes, oh yeah, we'll take care of it. Lo and behold, he apparently thought, you know what? We'll just leave the car on as we're switching the tires out.
Yeah. And
what happened? Sure enough, as the car is sitting there, you know, on the lift, getting the tires swapped out, that thing beeped and beeped and beeped. And so I got a lockout. And so now on Monday, I have to go back to the place and I'm hoping to avoid a huge fine. You know, because to them, it appears that I was driving my car and not breathing into the breathalyzer thing.
Oh, no.
How stupid is that?
What?
And all this, happened during the month of May. within weeks.
It's finished.
And then also, my car registration is due. It's just like one thing after another. I mean, it's absurd.
Like, why didn't he listen?
I don't know.
Yeah, because when it's on, it's gonna, like you told them, it's gonna have random alerts, and of course, it's gonna alert then.
Yeah, what's cool with this thing is you like submit on an app that's connected to the interlock. You submit that you're bringing your car in for maintenance, and so hopefully they see that and they see, hey, his car is in maintenance. Obviously, he wasn't behind the wheel. Right. Plus, all the GPS and stuff, they'll see it's just sitting at a car center or a tire center. Exactly. So hopefully, it's not that big of a deal, but it is frustrating.
And you have the invoices too, just in case.
Yeah.
But, oh man, that's so annoying. And AAA, I thought, has an app too, though, you know, right?
Well, I mean, I'm sure they do, but they want you to do the AI messaging thing. I mean, it worked fine. It was just, it was early in the morning and no one was available, I guess.
Oh, so annoying, man. You'd think those guys would wake up earlier.
Well, it's 24/7 roadside assistance, so someone's always on call. But I'm assuming early in the day, there's a minimum amount of people on call.
Well, May is behind you. It is now June 1st.
It's June 1st. We're recording at a much different time. Yeah. It is, what time is it? It's 8 o'clock on Saturday night. PM. And we're going to partay.
Woohoo!
I mean,
Saturday night, baby.
Discuss a lot of late night topics like UFOs and conspiracies and how stupid our government and possibly every system, judicial parts of our country are really.
Every branch.
Every branch. Thank you.
Everything the government does sucks.
This is episode 73 of the Uncovering Anomalies podcast. 74. I thought last week was 73 or 72. Never mind. All right. 74. Yeah. My apologies. 74 of the Uncovering Anomalies podcast. That is I Want to Know Adam.
Hey, everyone.
And I am the Topher T2000. Point me to John Connor.
Those are great movies.
Well, two of them are.
Two of them. Well, yeah, the third one it went downhill, and then they just got lost after that.
Yeah, I liked Salvation, the one with Batman, the guy who played Batman, Christian Bale.
Oh, I don't think I watched that one. It's one of the new ones.
It was fun. It doesn't make a whole lot of sense. I mean, the whole thing with the Terminators is they have no idea how timelines work, or they haven't decided how they want the timelines to work in their universe, and so it's very confusing to try and follow. You could essentially watch any of them without watching any of the other ones, and it's still it makes more sense than if you're trying to follow along with the thread.
I mean, it's a cool concept.
Yeah, definitely.
And it's something that can happen, you know, especially with time travel in there.
Yeah, I mean, and we're at that point right now with AI. I mean, it's not completely far-fetched.
No, it's not. And we're putting them in every single system that we have. We're plugging them into everything. But does that make it also like a takeover easier from like a foreign actor?
I'm thinking AI. Like if you can backdoor yourself into an AI that's installed on everyone's phone, hypothetically, or every, you know, system. Yeah, I suppose that would, I don't know anything truly about programming or AI or really much about computers. So I mean, how easy or difficult it would be.
Yeah, and it's what you train them. And we haven't seen, what is it called? Artificial general intelligence? Yeah, AGI, general intelligence. So that one is supposed to be like almost sentient, basically.
Eeks. Well, yeah. I still remember watching those Boston, what's the tech company in Boston? Where they were
Boston Dynamics.
Boston Dynamics, where they're like kicking the robots and pushing them. I mean, us humans, we've got it coming.
Man, I mean,
beating up on those robots.
China is already using those dogs with machine guns mounted on them.
Yeah,
they're walking around with the soldiers.
New York City was doing that a couple years ago at this point.
Dude, I mean, that's why they don't care about if we, you know, if depopulation happens. They don't care. There's robots to do their bidding.
Yeah. Plus, you know, the rich people are just going to upload their consciousness into essentially, you know, another robot body so they can live forever.
That's the plan. Yeah.
I mean, repercussions.
If they can use that body just like they use a human body and their brain just doesn't. I mean, the brain doesn't get old, does it? Is it deteriorating? Yeah, I guess it does.
I'm pretty sure it does. I mean, dementia is a thing.
Yeah. But what? They would want to digitize their mind? I don't even know if that's possible.
Yeah, I mean, the human brain is so complicated at this point. I don't think anyone can truly say if it's possible.
Yeah. I mean, I know that's what they're pushing. Bezos is investing billions of dollars into that.
Yep. Crazy that company started as a book sharing company or a book selling company. Isn't that nuts?
Well, and we talked about last week or a couple of weeks ago, his grandfather was part of DARPA.
Yeah. All these guys, from Bill Gates to Bezos to Elon Musk, they have real sketchy pasts.
Yes, and it's all intelligence.
These are not self-made millionaires. I mean, I know everyone talks about Steve Jobs working out of his garage, but I mean, even that is an exaggeration as to what really happened.
Oh, yeah, Steve Jobs. I'd like to dig into that. You're right. Everyone else has, like, ties to intelligence. Mm-hmm. Bill Gates' parents, I mean, they're very... And I think his mom was on the board of IBM or something.
Yeah.
None of these guys are really self-made. It took lots of connections, government contracts. Same thing with Musk. I mean, the guy's worth $200 billion. All his companies are government contractors.
Yep.
You know, we got tagged on this just recently, right before I got online. So it is a clear footage of a UAP UFO surveillance ball shaped drone of some type with camera that looks to be taking pictures, video of the area it's flying in. So let's take a look at this. I saw a lot of people are saying that it's a drone, but what kind of drone is a sphere? I mean, how is it flying? Do they have those?
I don't know. That's a really good question. Not that I'm aware of.
And it's got lights.
Whoa. Sort of,
yeah.
I don't think that's a drone. This is pretty clear footage.
Very clear. And how is it moving?
And it is totally spherical. Means of production seen in the video. Wow, where was this from? This is great. And that is a really cool video because it's not one of those far off in the distance blurry things. I mean, this thing was caught red-handed essentially.
Here's a zoom of it.
And it's flashing like it is taking pictures. Wow. That's
so bizarre. And how does it just come in to the view like that perfectly too? I mean, I guess.
Yeah.
Yeah, that's a sphere.
Wow, that is something else.
And it's displacing the air around it.
Well, thanks to whoever tagged us in this.
Good. Yes, we got tagged by Deep Ancient Thought. Thank you for that.
At Texas Mad E, two D's and an E at the end. Very cool.
AI fake, of course.
I don't
put the AI.
Higher quality original video looks to be downgraded to 360p, and I tried my best to upshot it and smooth the overlays and corrected the horizontal shape pattern of the video as a whole, but it didn't help that much. Huh. Well, I hope it's not AI because this is pretty cool footage.
It is really cool footage. So hopefully we're getting more. Oh, see how it drops like that?
Yeah. Bonk.
Whoa.
Yeah.
I mean, drones can do that.
I don't know if you remember. I mean, I've been obsessed with Skinwalker for a long time. One of the, I know we talked about the burning piles of hay that the owners had seen in the sky, but also they had seen, it doesn't look exactly like this, but it looks to be similar. Glowing orbs looked like they had some sort of liquid color on the inside and they would kind of float in and out. That's what this reminds me of. But this is obviously opaque and flashing lights, so it's a little bit different. But I mean, we're not completely out of the realm of, it's not completely crazy to assume this is some sort of UAP. As similar sightings have been seen.
Well, yeah. Remember when Kirkpatrick was cool, you know, in the beginning? He's the one who said that these orbs are seen all over the world.
Mm-hmm.
And those are really anomalous. And then he just left it alone.
Yeah. I mean, again, these are, they used to be called Foo Fighters.
Yeah. Yeah. Boop, 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 like surveillance drones, obviously. I wonder what's there. There was another guy. This guy works at Fermi Lab, so I guess they do quantum stuff. Close Encounters, man claims to see UFO over Kane County, but there's a secret base there or a secret lab called Fermi Labs.
Kane County is in Illinois, it looks like.
And that's the picture he took. Provided photo courtesy of Chris Fleming. And is this the story?
I had this fear when I saw it that if I start filming it, I'm going to get abducted. Why don't they just land and say who they are? Why can't we just get in their craft with them and fly around?
His reaction when he was driving on Kirk Road by Fermilab around 9:15 at night this week, claiming to have observed 12 UFOs in his lifetime, Chris Fleming describes the now famous Fermilab UFO.
Want to brag much? 12 UFOs?
I know, right? It's probably because this area, then. They're probably interested in what they're... So why was the UFO up 50 to 80 feet above Fermilab? Let's see what he says.
Is that the closest you've been to a UFO? Was that field at Fermilab?
No. Why don't they just land and say who they are? I mean, 1 and 2 in the morning. Why can't we just, like, you know, get in their craft with them and fly around? How cool would that be?
Why do you think UFOs are in our area?
Well, that's a big question. It could be very complex. They're always interested in what we're doing, maybe doing a reading or something of what's going on in the ground in Fermilab's a quantum physics underground facility. So I would assume they're probably looking at what they're doing at the quantum level, making sure there's no atomic. Concerned about our nuclear capabilities as well. Now they're obviously concerned about our quantum level and us, you know, ripping open a black hole or doing something with quantum physics that we know also created the atomic bond and the nuclear fission. So I assume they're looking at our technology so we don't destroy ourselves or wondering what we're going to do next.
Yeah, he's right. Once in DeKalb County near Sycamore on Plank Road, the 57-year-old Fleming had his UFO encounter.
several years ago, me and a friend saw a cigar craft that had to have been like 2 football fields length. It was rustic color. It looks like a giant hot dog in the air, but it has no wings. And that was shocking because we watched that for 8 minutes. That was probably the scariest thing I've ever seen in the sky. Hovering there, the DeKalb area, and it quickly flew like it was gone. And then I'm like, where'd it go? And then I had this fear when I saw it that if I start filming it, I'm going to get abducted or something's going to happen to me because it was so big and it was so sticking out in the sky. And then all of a sudden we looked farther to the right, many miles away, and there it was again. And it was moving kind of like a hockey puck or something on ice, very smooth with no sounds, no exhaust behind it, nothing. And then the strangest thing is it went towards this cloud. And as it went towards the cloud, perfect example. So if you took a pencil and you poked it through cotton or poked it through cotton candy, it's going to poke through the cotton or cotton candy, and it's going to pull it away from the rest of the cotton candy or the cotton. And that's what this was doing. And then all of a sudden it stopped. And then it was as if a fog or smoke started to appear around it, and it was encased in its own cloud, like mask itself. And I'm like, are you kidding me? And then all of a sudden it shot out and was gone.
Dude, that's crazy. This summer might be a good time to review or show your kids the classic E.T. or Close Encounters of Third Kind.
Oh, man. Close Encounters is so good. I haven't seen E.T. for a really long time, but I should go back and watch that.
Yeah, that's a classic. And it makes you hungry for Reese's Pieces.
I'm always hungry for Reese's Pieces. Chocolate peanut butter is probably my favorite combo of it.
Me too.
Or cherry lemon. Cherry lemon's also top one of mine.
Oh. You sent me this one. Retired FAA officer.
Yeah, I mean, this just harkens back. I think it was 1952. There was that huge flap over the White House.
Yeah.
This was a really cool video that this guy was able to catch. And he breaks it down. He was fortunate enough where during the filming of this video, he also captures what a bird, like there's a bird that flies in the frame. There's also a plane. Perfect. And it's, you know, you can juxtapose what's going on in the video between all those different things to show that it's not a bird. It's not a plane. It's not some sort of bug, because he captures those also in the same video. So,
great. And it's over DC.
Yeah. And it's got a cool soundtrack too, if I remember correctly.
Highly restricted airspace, DC. All right, let's put the sound on.
I've come to talk with you again. Because a vision softly creeping.
That's a bug.
Left its seeds while I was sleeping. And the vision that was planted in my brain still remains within the sound of silence. In restless dreams I walked alone. Narrow streets of cobblestone.
Look at it just tumbling. So it wasn't tumbling. They were just
they're dancing. They're doing whatever weird things UFOs do.
Yeah.
And I don't know if it's some sort of video artifact, but you can see there's kind of like a field around two UFOs, which I find interesting.
Wow, great catch. And they do that dance.
Yeah.
You know, it might be some charge or something. Wow. Great footage.
Anyway, yeah, another great piece of footage. Great job, whoever this was. Nikki Fly 23 on Reddit.
Reddit's good for news, and well,
it's a really news. The reason I won't give it up is because it's good. You can get all the information you want in one place instead of having to go to several different places. That's what makes it so, you know, desirable. It's just the people who run the website and the people who are on the website suck.
They do. I mean, there's a lot of times you send me things and it's deleted.
Yeah.
All right. You see this on remote trail. Man stumbles upon heavy, mysterious object, possibly from outer space.
Nice.
This thing is really, I mean, obviously human made, but what the hell? I mean, it's.
Yeah, that definitely is. And the way everything's spaced out, like perfectly spaced.
Just discovering a strange object that he thinks may be from outer space.
You can turn it up just a little bit, right?
Expected by aerospace experts, but the discovery has a lot of people scratching their heads. News 13's Mark Liverman explains.
I'm just shocked as to what it was.
Kind of hard not to be, especially when you find something like this along a very remote Canton trail.
Once in a lifetime. You know, it don't happen every day.
But it did happen to Justin Klontz when he and a co-worker found it. Burnt carbon fiber dotting the surface, heavy-duty pieces and plates of metal held together with what look like thick bolts.
Yeah, what the
Justin
hell?
Was working his job doing grounds maintenance at Glamping Collective in Glamping. Haven County. He walked about half a mile down this trail when his friend pointed it out.
We don't know what it is, so we just know that it's not from up here.
I just want to give you an idea of how big this object is. I stand at about 5'10", and you can see this thing comes past my waist. It's heavy duty. You can see all the reinforcements, the bolts, the carbon fiber.
It's like a bulletproof vest or something.
And then check this out. Look how thick this material is.
I want to see the other side of it. Almost an inch. Because I have a dumb theory.
The object's weight so heavy that Justin had to tow the thing.
I just tied a rope to it and drug it out with the lawnmower.
Hell yeah, brother.
Yeah. That it lands especially. If it landed somewhere off the trail in the woods, you'd never found it. But it just happened to land on the trail.
So what is it? And how did it even get here?
I looked up in the trees and stuff, and it just landed perfectly in the trail. And then through an opening in the woods.
So none of the trees or leaves around it looked like they had caught fire or anything like that?
No.
A piece of debris this big, you'd figure someone would have at least heard it land.
There's going to be some kind of a sound, you would assume.
Not up here. Once you get so far in that trail, you don't really hear nothing in the woods.
Glamping Collective's owner plans on reaching out to aerospace experts to figure out what this thing is and where it came from. Until then, this just remains a mystery in the mountains.
It's just a weird looking
Mark
thing.
Liverman.
It's man-made, right? We can agree on that.
Oh yeah, for sure. Definitely man-made. It's just, I mean, it's carbon fiber, and these bolts just look random. Like,
yeah, you know what? It reminds me of, weirdly enough, is like the bottom of a car seat.
Yeah, yeah, yes. It's definitely from a space vehicle. And it's like, maybe it has all that protection because, you know, this solar radiation.
Yeah, weird. Yeah, I wonder, something broke up in orbit and this came crashing down. But something this big would cause a lot of damage from orbit.
Exactly.
Think.
Yeah.
It'd be sitting inside of a crater.
He said it was just there and didn't hit any trees, nothing.
Yeah. Huh. Interesting.
They said that they reached out to some aerospace engineers. I wonder if they updated this. Where was this? Glamping Collective.
No, like state.
Yeah.
State was it? It's got to say at the top.
Oops.
What's that saying?
Haywood County. Where the hell is Haywood County? ABC 13 News. NC, North Carolina.
Yeah, there we go.
Yeah, nice. Definitely strange.
Yeah, actually, that part of the world's got some, like West Virginia also has some really cool, I mean, that's where Mothman was. There's up in the Appalachians, there's a lot of weird stuff. I think North Carolina's got Appalachians in it, right? Or am I confused?
Yeah.
I don't know the part of the country very well.
And also Colonel Glenn. Yeah, we covered this last on his contact in the desert. Wait, where's the other one? We'll get there. Oh no, yeah, so his contact in the desert. So that's happening. That race started off, touches down in Indian Wells, which is Palm Springs. And it's a huge event, huge UFO event. Everyone's there. Everyone. I mean, even all these guys on X, like some of these researchers, they're even doing presentations.
Cool.
Which is cool to see. I think they cover it here.
Close Encounter has landed right here in the desert. The 10th edition of Contact in the Desert Conference.
Oh.
You're kidding me. Why? I mean.
We were getting too close to the truth. We got shut down.
Oh, there it is.
Encounter has landed right here in the desert. The 10th edition of Contact in the Desert Conference started today in Indian Wells. This event stands as the pinnacle gathering for UFO enthusiasts, drawing participants from all around the world. It features more than 100 presentations, whatever that is that you're looking at, topics including ufology, artificial intelligence, ancient civilizations, space exploration, and more.
Got into ufology in the first place is back in the mid to late 70s, much like Skinwalker Ranch out there in Utah, I experienced a lot of things as a young girl. And so I've been trying to investigate how much of it is Black Access projects and how much of it is actual paranormal, unexplained UAPs and the like. So it's been a rabbit hole of investigations ever since. And I love it. I love the people. It's just a great time out here.
Hell yeah, lady.
If you're interested in getting involved, there's a few more days left. The conference runs through June 3rd and tickets are still on sale.
Make America great again. We hear that rally.
All right. So yeah, there's Contact in the Desert.
Where was that contact? It sounds like it was out here somewhere.
It's in Palm Springs.
Oh, nice. Okay. Palm Springs. Have you been to Palm Springs?
I have. They have the largest Walmart I have ever seen. It's like two Costcos.
I went with my girlfriend freshman year of college and had a really good time. But interesting place, Palm Springs.
Yeah, it is. I mean, they have a lot of events there too, right?
Yeah.
What is it called, that that music concert that everyone goes to? I mean, it's in the same area.
What, like Burning Man you're talking about?
No.
Because I thought that was further south.
No, not Burning Man. Can't remember the name anymore.
Coachella.
Coachella, you got it. Yeah, it's in the city next door.
Whatever the country one is called.
Right.
Yeah, I gotcha.
So, also, Blue Angels UFO.
I keep scrolling by. There's a Blue Angels documentary on Amazon. I'm not curious enough to watch it, but it's like aggressively being marketed to me. But cool. Another alleged UFO is spotted in NYC at the Blue Angels air show. Oh, that's a great photo.
So this is not the one, because there was one also that got them. That right before the pilots ejected, remember they caught a UFO also.
I've probably seen that. It sounds familiar, but I can't place it. But I mean, the Blue Angels are a lot of wow.
It was quick. Here, look at the original.
Zoom.
You see it?
Yeah. Wow.
Oh.
I mean, that's like Mach 50.
Yeah, it's insane. Blink of an eye.
I'm amazed the camera speed was even able to catch it.
TMZ is getting into this now.
Hell yeah, TMZ.
So that was really cool footage. And then there's another one in Nevada, also TMZ. Possible UFO spotted in the skies high above Nevada. Video. What day was this?
TMZ, get a better website.
Seriously, you have to have a date on there.
They probably have buckets of money. How are they? How is their website so stupid?
All right, here we go.
Hey, listen to all of our listeners out there. If you see a UFO, turn your flipping phone sideways. Do not film vertically. It is such a waste.
It is. It's moving really slow, though, huh?
Drop down right now.
Wait.
Look how it looks.
Look how it looks.
That looks like something in space, though.
I don't know. I have no idea.
Ooh.
Oh, wow.
What's this now coming in?
Yeah. Coming to hang out, figure out why his buddy's in the middle of exploding.
Yeah. It's still not very clear. I can't tell what this is.
Like, I mean, hell, that could be the moon in a on a fog.
Exactly.
Night. Yeah.
Right. Like they should at least put give us something. Like, you know, there's.
Yeah, that's the problem with night footage is you have no frame of reference.
Nope.
I mean, seriously, what are we looking at right now? We're looking at a gray screen with a bright light somewhere in the distance. That's nothing. Hell, that could be it. That could be a. I mean, this is in Nevada, so there's no lighthouses. But oh, now it disappeared. Okay, so maybe it's not the moon. Could have been a plane in the fog.
Okay, there are the street lights. All right, now we see.
Still, though, I don't know.
Yeah.
Not very compelling, but it's cool that people are taking such an interest in the sky.
It is. We need more people looking up. We need more smokers.
Always look up, people. When you're walking around at night or driving, don't look at the road. Don't look in front of you. Just have just stare straight up at the sky.
Uh-oh. I see a liability.
That is a joke. Wink, wink.
Aliens are interacting with humans. Retired Army colonel. Is that retired?
Yeah. Is it? Yeah. I think it's retired.
We did cover this last week, though.
Yeah. And this is, he's far from the only person that has said this. There's been a lot of former military and governmental people that have the same sentiment.
Yeah, and this article goes through that the Pentagon has denied these allegations, even though these high-ranking officials, and we did mention that the audience in the SALT conference, those are like corporate executives, you know, very high-level individual, and they're trying to convince these people because they can convince Congress then to go ahead and pass the UAP Disclosure Act.
Mm-hmm.
Because, yeah, I mean, again, it's just talking. We haven't seen any physical evidence. And the only way to get that is to get the government to work moving on this.
Yeah. So now, hey, government, if you're listening, now's the perfect time. The elections are coming up. You need a distraction? Release some information about UFOs. Release some proof.
Yeah, that is a distraction. Oh, yeah. So they did now. Congressman Robert Garcia files UAP Disclosure Act as possible House floor amendment to NDAA. That was May 30th, so a couple days ago.
Was that? Oh yeah, a couple days ago. I was gonna say I thought that was yesterday, but that was the 31st.
So we're trying again. So people, get in touch with your representatives. Tell them you want this. You want the UAP Disclosure Act to pass this time and not to be gutted. It does introduce some new whistleblower protections. I guess they need more because I think they've done this like three times now, and I think they've put something in there where they don't have to go to Arrow. If they're scared that they're going to be compromised, they can go straight to Congress. And
definitely, whatever you do, do not dress up as an alien, sneak into your congressperson's house, and pretend to be an alien and tell them they need to vote yes on this. Definitely don't do that.
No. Please use email or their contact lists or call them.
Yeah. Definitely don't dress up as an alien and show up at their house. And sneak inside and
sneak inside.
Definitely don't do that. And aliens, if you're listening, definitely don't do that.
Oh yeah, definitely. I mean, you guys are definitely, well, they've learned, they've been shot at since the 50s, haven't they?
Yeah.
Those stories are all so funny in the farms.
The Rules Committee expects to meet during the week of June 10th to decide which amendments to HR 8070 will be made in order for consideration on the House floor around mid-June. Typically, the Rules Committee receives hundreds of proposed amendments to the annual NDAA, of which only a fraction are made in order for floor consideration.
Cool. Good to see some movement on this. I hope if this one passes this year, man, who knows what's going to happen? Because
yep.
Every time we get close to disclosure, something bad happens and it's like gets all reset again.
Mm-hmm.
And he's Merrick VR. He goes, I hope that the extraordinary constitutional issues raised here are apparent. Congress insinuating that the executive, a co-equal branch of government, is concealing critical information is enormously significant and potentially monumental. So that's what Congress is saying. Congress is saying that the executive branch has information about the reality of UFOs, and that's why they're passing these laws. The Senate Intelligence Committee believes that unreported illegal legacy UAP programs exist.
Oh, we know that.
Yep. Does not trust Arrow Kirkpatrick.
Well, no one should.
This is based on Senator Round's indications of a UAPDA 2.0, which we just saw, the GAO review of Aero.
That's what we talked about last week, right?
Yep.
Yeah.
And the new whistleblower protections. So, yeah, he's highlighting this.
And as we know, our country loves to protect whistleblowers.
Oh, yeah. We're so great with that.
Hi, Snowden. Hope Russia's not too cold.
Snowden.
WikiLeaks. Well,
who was that? Oh, yeah. William Binney. He was a NSA whistleblower. He was really smart, though. I don't know how he did it, but he got immunity from the government. His story is really funny. They showed up at his house at like 6 in the morning. He was taking a shower, and all of a sudden he sees guys with guns pointed at him. And he was a whistleblower that's going to say that was going to, well, he did tell us that he created this program that you can spy on anyone using anything. If it's electronic, if it's an email, if it's a phone call, if it's a text message. But he was told that he was creating it for foreign reasons. And then he found out that the government was going to use it on Americans. And that's why he became a whistleblower. He's a cool guy, real patriot. But they put him through hell. Like you said, I mean, whistleblowers are really not protected here.
Yeah, I mean, hell, look at what Boeing's just got unilateral permission to do with their whistleblowers.
That's such an insane story. Like, it doesn't get any coverage. Like, you'd think the news would cover that.
No, I don't think the news would cover that because they're paid not to. I mean, it's so obvious that our media is controlled by the government. I mean, it's absurd.
Yeah, this whole system is owned by just a few people.
Corrupt, top to bottom.
So there's a passage in the Mike Rounds amendment. It says increases transparency on UAP-related government programs by requiring further reporting of all activity involving UAPs protected under special or restricted access to appropriate congressional committees. All right, so Congress is going to get the information. Doesn't mean we will, though.
Get on it, Burchette. Tell us all we want to know.
Dag nabbit.
Dag nabbit.
Now, this is a cool clip, but it might not be, the sound might be too muffled, so just let me know. Okay. But this is an Air Force Lieutenant Colonel Richard French, was an alleged lead investigator of Project Blue Book in the 1950s. In Newfoundland, one day, he watched what appeared to him to be two ETs performing repairs on a submerged unknown circular craft.
Oh, hell yeah. USO. We don't see those too often.
No. All right, let's listen to him.
Water was very clear. You could see now as much as 200 feet in it. And with what I saw down there were two UFOs parked side by side, but I couldn't see anyone around either one of them. Then a little later, someone moved one of the UFO occupants, and I guess go ahead and call him up the RDM. Moved over to the side and he came into my line of sight. Very soon after that, he came out of the water going approximately 100 miles an hour. As soon as he broke the surface of the water, he increased his speed to approximately 2,500 miles an hour and quickly went out of sight. He was gone for about 15 or 20 minutes. He came right back, right when it slowed down. Very much went in the water again at about 100 miles an hour, went on down to, and he and the other one, you could see them working on the UFOs. After about approximately 2 hours of apparently performing maintenance on the UFOs, the two of them took off together again. When left the water at about 100 miles an hour, immediately accelerated to well over 2,500 miles an hour, going virtually straight up and disappeared.
Crazy. How come we don't see that? How come I don't see that?
Right? the audio was fine, a little rough, but for those of you who want to, if you couldn't understand it, just, you know, watch the video. They have subtitles, so you can read it all through.
Now Japan is joining in.
Woo!
Japan lawmakers to create group for government probes into UFOs.
All right. Yeah, actually, you know, now that I'm thinking about it, I can't name a single, because I don't think aliens and UFOs really are in kind of the Japanese zeitgeist as much.
They're not.
Because I know, like, I know, obviously, the U.S., South America, Europe, even Africa, certain parts, they have a lot of, I mean, we've talked about the aerial school in South Africa, but there's also a lot of shaman that deal with UFOs, stuff like that. But Japan, I don't know if I've ever heard. Actually, you know what? I take it back. There yeah, was no, that there story of that redheaded woman that washed up on shore, like,
oh yeah,
like 4,000 years. I have no idea. I'm just pulling a number out of my head. And she was like, on a metal boat, mm-hmm. and then ended up kicking her back out into the ocean because they didn't know what to do with her.
Yeah, I remember that story. I think we covered it here.
Yeah, I'm pretty sure we did a long time ago. Yeah.
And in general, they have I remember, like, if anything happens, like here, like more like Bob Lazar or Travis Walton, like the Japanese media were one of the first ones here covering it. There is that old cartoon called Grandizer. So that's all about UFOs and aliens. So, you know, I mean, I'm sure there's a lot more than that.
Mm-hmm.
But space, I mean, those nukes, you know,
really just completely changed the culture of Japan.
Yeah.
At World War II. For those who want to really ruin your day, go check out Unit 731. All the things that they did, the atrocities they committed during World War II.
Is that the Japanese?
Yes.
Oh yeah. Yeah. They raped and pillaged, right?
No, that was like the rape of Nanking was bad, but Unit 731 were doing experiments that made the Nazis blush. Like literally the Nazis were like, whoa, this is way too far. Like stuff like they'd complete, like I remember one story, they would do things just to see what would happen. So they'd freeze a guy's hands completely solid and then force him to put his hands into boiling water. Things
oh
like
my
that.
God.
It wasn't really a form of torture. It was just they had all these people and were like, hey, let's do some experiments. But and as far as I remember, the same thing happened to them as what we did with the Nazis after World War II. We divided up all of their knowledge they had gained and their scientists and split them up between different winning countries.
I mean, imagine. I mean, they're just an island, you know, and they wanted to take over the world and have an empire. Shows how capable and smart they are.
Well, you know, but after the two nukes dropped, I mean, they completely, you know, thankfully changed directions.
Yeah, exactly. Like, all right, screw this. We'll just go into a consumer economy and just build electronics.
Yeah.
And they've robots. Been
very successful at that.
Oh, yeah. Big time. Big time. They're still, was it number five or six largest economy? And again, they're just a small island. They're not that big.
Mm-hmm. You know, and they're all, you know, I mean, it's kind of amazing how their whole culture, you know, is. Like, everyone is really thin. They walk and use public transportation as much as possible, even though they're shoved in like sardines.
Yeah.
You know, and obviously a very hardworking, hard-driven people. One of the most interesting things I've found about Japanese work culture is if you're found asleep at your desk, that's a sign of I've been working so hard I couldn't keep my eyes open, and you're applauded for it.
What? Really?
Yeah. And it's not because, and it's not like the Japanese workers are actually just being lazy, and it's literally because they've been there for 36 hours straight, and this is the only chance, this 15 minutes they get to take a nap, and so it's not looked down upon. Like, I couldn't fall asleep at my desk, I get fired.
Oh, you're right. Yeah. You know, even in Korea was like that. When I used to go there at some board meeting, some of the guys were sleeping and no one was saying anything, you know, and it's probably because of that, because they know they've been working all night.
Yeah. Yeah. It's a very, very interesting culture.
Yeah. So this group will hold its founding general meeting on June 6th after Tuesday's preparatory meeting, which was held in Parliament. The lawmaker group will urge the government to gather and analyze information on UAP and
pursue cooperation with Washington.
Oh, no.
So now we can infiltrate Japan's UAP products and shut it down.
Oh, man, you're kidding. Why can't you just do it in its founding statement? The group said that if UAP, which have been witnessed many times over Japanese territory, are cutting-edge secret weapons or unmanned spy drones from other countries, they would present a major security threat to Japan. All right.
Well, I hope they succeed in this. I really hope they don't get completely trampled over by Washington's UAP groups, because we've been shown to do that.
Like, I mean, I guess if they if they find something anomalous, then they'll ask Washington. But I mean, it's just going to be whitewashed then.
Yeah. Oh, you didn't see anything.
Someone
threw a rock in front of the camera. That's
don't worry about it. It's one of ours. I don't know how it, like, you know, ended up over your airspace.
Right.
What do we have next? Oh, so the government, they're talking about the UK government, has been making plans for finding aliens.
Oi, mate. I don't know if that was British enough.
The government is officially gearing up for the discovery of aliens, a move described as long overdue.
All right. Freedom of Information Requests has revealed that the Department for Science, Innovation, and Technology, DSIT, is currently researching how it will react to the so-called, quote-unquote, Black Swan event that is discovering extraterrestrial life, including announcing the find to the public. The Black Swan event is an unpredictable event that has wide-ranging consequences, but in hindsight, appears to have been inevitable.
Right.
Cool. Report is investigating whether a plan already exists. None has ever been made public. What a plan would look like and how the UK can be on the front foot should and such an astounding scientific discovery finally be made.
So imagine if someone beats us to it. Yeah, that's not going to happen. Our government, like, seriously runs the world. Like, no other government will do anything without permission.
I know. Well, honestly, truly, if something were to come out of the UK and it was like first, like you said, the US would do everything to discredit it. Oh no, that's a Russian spy plane. Oh no, that's a bird. Even if it landed on the Parliament building.
They're looking for biosignatures in space. Worst case scenario, we might be facing an existential threat.
Woo!
No email.
Get out of here.
Yeah, nothing more than that. But I mean, it's good to see that UK is, I mean, now Japan has this going on. We have this going on. UK has this. So something's happening, right? Mm-hmm. Things are moving. Yeah.
2030 is right around the corner, folks.
Oh, man, I hope they don't wait that long.
Oh, I knew that was Europa. I was going to guess that. I was like, that's definitely Europa, and I didn't say anything.
Oh, I thought, oh, nice. When I was scrolling by, I thought it was Pluto.
Nah, that's, oh, I've seen, there's, oh, man, Europa's really cool. There's it's just a frozen thing, and they think there's water under it.
Yeah, a huge ocean underneath that ice.
It's got volcanic activity, if I remember correctly.
Shouldn't we be there now? You know what I mean? Like, that is for sure. If there's an ocean under there, for sure there's got to be life.
I have to imagine it's pretty difficult to get there. Plus, I watched.
I think we covered something. This year they're launching it, right? This year they're launching.
Yeah, I was going to say, I think we covered it. Was it last week or the week before?
Yeah. Both NASA and the European Space Agency currently have missions bound for Jupiter's icy moons. There we go. Thought by many to be the best place to find life in the solar system. While last month, the U.S. agency confirmed it was progressing with its Dragonfly mission to Saturn's organic-rich moon, Titan.
Titan's the other big one. I know we're trying to get there.
Isn't Titan the one with the lava volcanoes?
It's the one that supposedly should be habitable with minor alterations to the planet. Well, it's a moon around Saturn.
Right, yeah. I mean,
I think we, a couple weeks ago, we posted that photo that the Hubble, the new one, had taken.
Oh, yeah, JWST.
Yeah, had taken photos. I think it was of Titan, and it had so
many. It was Titan.
And they had a bunch, there was a bunch of different colors that were coming through instead of just.
It looked like Earth.
Yeah.
Yeah, you're right. I mean, if we go back to the 50s and stuff, all the aliens that were being encountered were from the solar system. Then they became, like, you know, from another.
Mm-hmm.
Another star system after that.
Plus, you know, Saturn is weird enough. It's got that hexagon on the North Pole, you know, and everyone's weirded out. Well, not everyone. A lot of deep conspiracy people have a lot of theories about the hexagon on the top of the planet.
Right. And Saturn, you know, it's Saturday, right? And the Jewish religion, they take off on Saturday. They put a cube on their head. The Muslims have the Kaaba, which is a cube that they go around in Mecca. The cross, when it's folded up, when you fold up the cross, it's a cube. And then that's what's on top of Saturn. It's bizarre.
Yeah, and it's got those big, sexy rings.
We've talked about rings of Saturn, too, here.
Mm-hmm.
That NASA scientist that said that he found evidence that there are huge ships making those rings.
Yeah, we talked about that a long time ago. Yeah, I remember.
Yeah. So yeah, it's a very mysterious planet. So it'll be cool once we send that like to Titan. So Titan is Saturn, right? It's not Jupiter.
Titan is Saturn. Wait, okay, hold Titan's on.
And Europa. So both of those are
Saturn. No. Europa is Jupiter.
Oh, Europa is Jupiter. Okay.
Yeah. As Mr. Pope mentioned, rumors are swirling that the James Webb Space Telescope has already found evidence of life. In September, NASA revealed that the groundbreaking satellite had detected traces of dimethyl sulfide, a compound that on Earth is only produced by life, primarily phytoplankton. Many argue that if or when humans discover life beyond their own planets, it will be microscopic. Perhaps it will be the telltale signs of long-gone bacteria on Mars or deep-sea-dwelling microbes on an icy moon, Europa.
Boring.
While that finding may not have the same societal impact as discovering an advanced civilization, it would still be momentous. Yes, it absolutely would.
Yeah,
because if you find little microbes on, you know, Titan or Europa or Mars or whatever, that means there's life other than the life on our own planet, regardless of not if they're walking around with two legs and big eyes and sending probes up our butts.
True. And then, you know, maybe that's part of the whole disclosure process that, you know, you just start slowly. Oh, it's microbes. Oh, it's fish. Oh, it's, you know, animals on four legs. Oh, look, a humanoid.
Mm-hmm. Slowly but surely.
Yes. And then, so this was sent to us underneath last week's.
Because we talked about, oh, yeah, and I want to talk about Terrence Howard a little bit.
Oh, yeah, sure, yeah. We talked about him last week.
That was last week. So I mentioned the whole thing about he believes 1 times 1 equals 2, and I looked into it. And so I kind of almost get where he's coming from in a schizophrenic way, because what he's saying is, if you think about it this way, if you've got one cell, and it multiplies itself, as in it splits and becomes two. You've got two. So one cell multiplying itself once, you have two.
Right.
Makes sense, right? But if you use that logic again, you've got two cells that multiply, each multiply themselves twice.
Then you have four.
Yeah, I'm trying to picture in my head. Anyway.
And another argument he was saying is that you have the equal sign there. So... which means on each side of the equal sign, it has to, you know, they have to equal each other. So 1 times 1 equals 1. That does not equal on both sides.
Well, that's the thing. Okay, so that was the main thing that I was able to discern is he's confusing like mathematics and biology. If a thing multiplies itself, there's two of it. But that's in biology. If you multiply one by one, you equal one. Because if you've got one thing and you say, hey, I want that one thing, you still have the one thing. You know what I'm saying?
Right. Yeah. Yeah. I get it. And I get where he's coming from too, but I think he takes it to another dimension where he says that it's all based on a lie then.
Yeah.
And that's the issue that we have. I mean, he has other great points, you know, that everything is electricity. Everything is in motion, constantly in motion.
And you know,
sacred geometry.
Everyone treats math like it's a absolute definite, and in 99% it is. But I mean, you talked about last week, I mean, physics, it doesn't match up to that's why they keep having to introduce things like dark matter, dark energy, imaginary numbers. I mean, I don't really know math that well. I used to. I got all the way up to trig in high school, and then it's true that if you don't use it, you lose it, because I never had to do math after high school.
For sure.
I mean, I think I took an algebra 2 class in college just to get my math credit in.
Oh, okay.
You don't.
I got a Calc 3 in college.
I didn't need it. I mean, I have a degree in business, but you have to know how to, like. So I took a lot of the business accounting, but that's just adding and subtracting. I mean, it's not real
credit debit.
Yeah, credit debit. I mean, it's not as complicated as calculus.
Yeah, I mean, Calculus 3 is so tough that you have to use a program called MathCAD. You can't do it on your own or on a calculator. You have to use a computer.
Yeah, and if I remember right about trigonometry, you're essentially adding words together. So you've got sine, cosine, and tangent. I can't remember.
Yeah,
you're adding words together that mean number. It's very complicated. But I remember being pretty good at it, and then for like a decade after that, I didn't ever have to use any of those math skills. And I know
what you mean. Unless you're a programmer or something and writing algorithms, it's not gonna.
And I'm at the age where I'm old enough to remember when my teachers were saying, hey, you need to learn this math because you'll never have a calculator handy. You won't be able to carry a calculator in your pocket all the time. And, you know, that clearly didn't turn out so true.
But yeah, Terrence Howard is everywhere. I mean, if I'm on Instagram, on TikTok, everyone is just cutting up these clips and putting them up. I mean, each one has like millions of views.
Yeah.
You know, and of course you have the mainstream scientists saying that it's all BS and he doesn't know what he's talking about. Of course, he's not a scientist, so they're going to say that to him.
Well, yeah, and as we have seen over the last few years, especially with COVID, all scientists are infallible and do can say no wrong.
And so this was sent to us. It's a Holcomb energy system, and apparently it makes electricity from the ether or from the vacuum of space. It draws in these electrons and generates electricity.
Very interesting.
Yeah.
That are able to change. Dr. Robert Holcomb is a retired medical doctor who practiced neurology and was a professor at the Vanderbilt University School of Medicine. He is the prolific inventor who has developed a breakthrough that I think will be one of the greatest inventions in history. I believe it will cause a paradigm shift that will affect almost every aspect of life and will eventually solve many major problems in the world. This invention employs the interaction of electron spins to capture ambient energy fluctuations. The generators shown in this picture are able to produce electrical energy indefinitely without any need for fuel or other external sources of energy. The Holcomb energy device can be run as an energy multiplier or a self-sustaining generator. Dr. Holcomb has been quietly developing this technology for over 15 years after discovering the electron spin energy capture effect. The Holcomb Energy System Generator uses standard generator and motor winding technology, so it can be built without any exotic technology. It is made of the same parts as an ordinary electric motor or generator, but it has no moving parts. Ordinary industrial motor control electronics, like solid-state relays, are controlled by industrial computers called programmable logic controllers to sequentially energize the center electromagnets in the device to create a rotating magnetic field with no mechanical motion. Electricity is induced in the other stator coils by the sweeping magnetic fields in the device, which gain energy at the atomic level from the electron spin ratchet mechanism due to the quantum exchange force interactions. The Holcomb Energy System, or HES, has no moving parts, unlike conventional synchronous electric generators, which have rotors that must be turned by an engine or other mechanical energy source. The HES switches electric current to the electromagnet coils in a stationary iron or steel coil. This switching action is controlled by a computer, which is the programmable logic controller or other computer. The rotating magnetic fields are created in the core, which are magnetically coupled to a concentric iron cylinder known as the stator. The current is induced in the stationary stator coils as the magnetic field sweeps through them. This is according to the principles of magnetic induction discovered by Michael Faraday in 1831, the same principle used in conventional generators. However, since the HES has no moving parts, there is no back torque, and the Lenz's law is overcome by what Dr. Holcomb calls the energy from the electron spins. Like some of the previously described magnetic energy devices, I believe that the HES employs the phenomena that occurs in iron and other ferromagnetic materials, which allows it to capture the microscopic fluctuations that occur at the atomic scale as an energy source using the interactions of electron spins acting as ratchet mechanisms due to the quantum exchange force between the iron atoms. In conventional generators, this captured energy is wasted in the turbulent chaos created by the collapse of the magnetic fields when they are forced to reverse magnetic direction by 180 degrees. The sweeping magnetic fields of the HES avoid the chaos by not collapsing the fields, and so it is able to make use of the captured energy. It's actually a really brilliant and simple idea. And while there have been a few people in the past that have had similar ideas, Dr. Holcomb is the first to bring this out into practical devices that are actually being used today. The Holcomb Energy System, or HES, can be installed by electricians in a commercial, industrial, or residential installation.
You're kidding me.
The HES can be completely self-powering, but to be less disruptive, it is first marketed as an electrical power-saving device, which will reduce the power bill to a building by at least one half. This version is known as the inline power generator, or ILPG. Several of these generators have been installed now in industrial facilities for about 3 years, generating power 24 hours per day.
What?
Holcomb Energy Systems is currently making arrangements to have them produced by companies that manufacture electric motors and generators. Hopefully, this will provide many much-needed jobs for skilled technicians. The Holcomb Energy System, HES, is a scientific breakthrough in 100% clean energy with no moving parts, solid state. It presents an entirely new source of true electric power generation capable of addressing critical global issues such as climate change, pollution, and universal access to electric.
Very cool, man. So this was, he said, they said they've been in, been working for 3 years.
Wow.
Doesn't, no moving parts, nothing. That's amazing.
Yeah, I want to see this in action.
Right? Holcomb Energy System.
And should we say who sent this to us?
How am I going to find out? I think it was on my personal account when I shared the,
it wasn't someone that shared on a YouTube comment?
No, it was on, yeah, it was on Twitter.
Well, thank you, stranger, for sending this our way. Please continue to do so.
Yeah, I mean, I had no idea about this thing. We're always looking out for these new things, and we're always saying that these inventors get killed, and these plans get stolen, and you know what I mean?
Yeah, I mean, look at the people who were trying to invent electric cars or alternate energy cars in like the 50s and 60s. They all mysteriously died under very shady circumstances.
So yeah, cool. We have, you know, as long as we don't blow ourselves up, we do have a good future, you know, that doesn't have to be on oil and gas and pollution, and just using these simple inventions that take with that what's ever out there already in the universe, you know, with this constant motion going on, and it's just tapping into that, taking advantage of that, and having energy that we can use. I mean, if each house has that, you don't have to pay for electricity. It's just a one-time payment, really.
Yeah.
Or
installation fee. I know all about those over these last few weeks.
Installation.
That's where they get you.
So Richard, he's actually presenting at Contact in the Desert, actually. So he's a great researcher. He found this the day before Roswell, July 7th, 1947, Fort Worth Star Telegram, plane forced to dodge him, disc cavort all over U.S.
That's definitely a 1940s headline.
Yeah,
disc cavort all over U.S. while mystery deepens.
So flying disc.
Icy in 82 degree heat. What? Is that part of the same article?
No, here.
Oh, someone dropped a bunch of ice. Never mind. I thought that was like part of the UFO thing. I was like, whoa. No.
You know how newspapers do that.
Yeah.
So flying discs, have you seen one? Develop new angles and behavior patterns, according to Monday's accumulation of news dispatches. Casey Baird, pilot of a P-38 working for the United States Geodetic Survey, reported at Bozeman, Montana.
Yeah.
He was forced to evade a group of flying discs at 32,000 feet. And then it cuts off.
Wow. I'm assuming he posts the whole, or yeah, I see the whole article, I think, up there. He linked it.
So there was no drones back then, people, in 1947. Don't tell me that there were, okay?
His photographer tried to get a picture. To him, they looked like yo-yos with a periscope or dome on top and were 14 to 15 feet in diameter.
Not very big.
Francis Howell in Tempe, Arizona. He saw a circular object about 2 feet in diameter float to earth near his home, but when he, his wife, and several neighbors approached the spot, the flat, thin object rose slowly at a 45 degree angle and took off toward the northwest. Howell described it as of transparent aluminum. So as we can see, the eyewitnesses consistently see the same type of object, a transparent aluminum, you know, liquid metal, all things, all various ways to describe the same thing. Very interesting. Eight land on mountain. So far, there's been no report. This sounds like it's just a bunch of different UFO sightings in 1947.
Yep.
Cool stuff, though.
Very cool stuff. And this is a cool website, newspapers.com.
Yeah, it's great, smart. It reminds me of, I mean, microfiche isn't really allowed or around anymore, but it kind of reminds me of that.
So yeah, you search the largest online newspaper archive. So you can put in any word, any date, and you can, you know, find what the newspapers were reporting on before they were bought up by the parasitic class.
Wait, I want to read that last one. House's cow is scared. A Coloradan reported seeing a flying saucer that made a hollow booming noise and Northwest Arkansas rancher, saw yellow discs the size of pancakes that scared his horses and cows. Another quote unquote angle was supplied by Harold Jessen, Austin architect, who reported sighting a high-speed object over the Texas Capitol Sunday afternoon. It was traveling eastward in very weird font, and he watched it for a full minute. So people have been going nuts over these, and it's weird because these are all objects. You know, when people see them today, are they seem to be very similar?
It's the same ones. It's the same ones. It's like something that's been here, right, for a long time,
mm-hmm.
interacting with humanity for a long time.
Yep.
Oh, this. Now, I don't like to get into like the drama of the UFO community, but the last interview with Kirkpatrick, with Stephen Greenstreet, when he asked him, were you at the Skinwalker Ranch presentation? Skinwalker Ranch gave a presentation, and the U.S. government sent Kirkpatrick over there. So now Kirkpatrick said he never went to that meeting. Okay. And it was said that Kirkpatrick in that meeting said, could you go ahead and skip over the slides trying to prove the reality of UFOs. We all know it's real. You know what I mean? So he's denied being at the meeting, and he's denied saying that. So,
and as we know, Kirkpatrick does nothing but tell the truth. He's an honest guy that never lies.
Right. Yeah, he doesn't lie at all. And he does all these interviews. So Fugel, who's the owner of Skinwalker Ranch, disproves Kirkpatrick's denial. He sent pictures. Where is it? There are pictures that he sent with Kirkpatrick being there. Like I said, Greenstreet.
Just incredible that these people are supposed to be taken seriously. The Kirkpatrick and people who believe him. It's just ridiculous. On April 19th, 2018, my team from Skinwalker Ranch was asked to provide a confidential briefing in Washington, D.C. to the U.S. Senate Select Committee on Intelligence and United States Armed Service Committee. Sean Kirkpatrick was at the head of the table. It lasted 2.5 hours, and he's posting photos. This is Brandon Fugel on X, formerly known as Twitter, by the way.
There he is. There he is. He's heading the meeting, and here it is. Confidential briefing, Skinwalker Ranch, U.S. Senate Select Committee on Intelligence. I see here. No, there's Fugel's there though, and that's Hal Putoff. I don't know who this guy is or that guy. There's Hal Putoff right here too. Is he? Well, he's attentive. That's him right there.
Mm-hmm.
You can't deny it. Just let's go back to that article. Oh nope. Wait. Oh. Okay, I didn't leave the article. There it is. Here's the presentation. And the next photo was taken clearly showing Fugel giving the presentation with a slide about Skinwalker Ranch and Kirkpatrick in attendance. There he is. It's a nice hotel room.
Yeah, no kidding.
You can also see a close-up of Kirkpatrick.
I don't want to see him close up. I want to see that ugly mug close up. Any chance there are timestamps on the photos? And Fugel responds, I have the complete metadata intact showing the briefing occurred at on April 19th, 2018, between 1 to 3:30 p.m. Eastern time. That particular photo was taken at 1:31 p.m.
Huh.
He's just saying that, though. He's not posting proof. But I don't know. I mean, I have a hard time believing he'd make this up. He clarified that this was not a classified briefing, just a confidential one, and he didn't sign any NDAs, and that the photo was taken discreetly without permission because he thought he might need proof later.
Oh, that's smart. Foresight. Yeah, he knew it. He knows how the government is.
There weren't supposed to be cameras. I instructed our paralegal to discreetly create a record of it in case I needed it in the future. Smart guy.
Uh-huh. That's why he's a billionaire.
Yeah.
When asked what the slide was that you can see in the photo with Kirkpatrick, he shared the exact slide.
Cool. I was wondering the same thing.
Of course, I remember. It was a slide outlining phase one activities at Skinwalker Ranch associated with my investigation beginning as a skeptic in April 2016 to March 2017, creating the foundation for what was to come.
Cool.
Yeah. So
I always love, I think the most fascinating, not most interesting, how do I say this? People who are skeptics and become believers, I take their words for it much more than I do someone who is full skeptic or full believer. And
full believer, same. Yeah. Yeah.
Just like, the guy who
Hynek.
Hynek, thank you, J.L. Hynek. He was a skeptic turned believer. And he was a hardcore scientist guy. Like, he was no nonsense.
Yeah, I mean, he was there to debunk it all. And then when he realized that, you know, there was some cases that need more investigation, the government's like, no, we're not going to investigate it. And he thought that was weird.
This is why I think UFOs gained so much traction. I think the government found the biggest wet blanket, hard-nosed, evidence-only guy they could find in J. Allen Hynek, put him in Project Blue Book and said, okay, go debunk all this. It's nonsense. And he comes back saying, I can't debunk some of these. What the hell is going on? And, you know, of course, after that, he got shunned.
Yeah, and I don't think Kirkpatrick's going to be that way. Just to see the way he loves being what he is.
He's playing the role he's been given, and it's not going to change. They probably have some blackmail on him. Just look at this.
His flash drive, Fugle's flash drive, disappeared just before the meeting.
Shocker.
Yeah, Fugle also revealed some strange things happened just before the meeting, including the disappearance of his flash drive with all his presentation slides and notes.
How did you get the presentation then?
I don't know.
The flash drive containing the briefings was stolen from my room, which was in the presidential suite of the, Grand Hyatt in Washington, D.C. the morning of the briefing while locked and attending a quick meeting at my Collier's International D.C. office located nearby. I reported the situation to hotel security and front desk. Fortunately, and to my surprise and relief, my principal investigator and scientist, Eric Bart, has saved a copy to his laptop the night before. Okay, great.
Wow. That
answers my question.
These guys are smart. They know.
Yeah, always back up your work if you're a UFO scientist, because they will get you.
And take pictures.
Put up a dead man's drop like Assange was supposed to do. Or no, it wasn't Assange. It was the guy who did the ad blocker thing. The crazy guy. Mm-hmm. He died a couple years back. Come on. What's that antivirus system on Windows?
Oh, McAfee.
Yeah, McAfee.
Yeah.
Yeah. That he supposedly had set up a dead drop, and I don't think that ever happened.
No, it never happened. It supposedly happened on Telegram, but it was like a fake account. Yeah. So cool. I mean, if he didn't have that picture, Kirkpatrick would have been his word against Kirkpatrick's word.
Could have gotten away with it.
I know. And now, of course, there is a new interview with Green Street and Kirkpatrick, part two. And, you know, he's gonna clear that all up. I mean, it's obviously Green Street works for the feds. You know, why is he doing all these interviews?
I was just about to make a really it was a dark humor joke about gargling the balls of the government. But anyway, yeah, let's go ahead. Let's skip past that. Pretend I didn't say anything and play what we've got here.
So this is on Joe Rogan. Graham Hancock was on there, and they talk about the DMT and the DMT realm. So it goes into consciousness and the entities that reside there. I mean, I would like to do DMT or ayahuasca one of these days.
I would too, but I really need to be surrounded in a safe environment, surrounded by safe people. I don't think I would respond well to any of these.
Yeah, I mean, if we go together, there's a shaman there that actually takes you through the journey. You know, that's how it's done, and it's out in nature, and you're surrounded by, you know, it's good vibes and all that kind of thing. And that's how I wouldn't recommend doing it just like in your house or something.
No.
Yeah, there should definitely be an environment which is positive, and you have people there that you trust, because it can be hectic.
I'm wondering, I maybe should start small, like do like microdose psilocybin or something before just making the jump to DMT. Because
if
DMT,
you remember, can
really screw you up from what I
remember. We had a guest on, Kay. So she did it, and now she's so obsessed that she got certified as a practitioner. So she will,
really?
She would take people now if they want to do a trip on mushrooms, like microdosing, she will help them on that trip. And it's changed her completely.
Next time she's in town, let's do that.
Okay.
I have a friend who I've kept in touch with from high school, who I keep in touch with, and one of her things is microdosing LSD, and so you're not completely tripping out. But she says it just makes her super creative, and she doesn't do it like constantly, but or very, very frequently, but it's just a nice way to chill, apparently.
I didn't know LSD was a thing.
Was it LSD or mushrooms? I can't remember. It was one of the hallucinogens she microdoses with her dad, apparently. I don't know.
I mean, that's a crazy story, LSD, too. You know, it was completely by accident, right? And the guy who created it took it, and he was on a bike ride, and he had, like, this amazing experience. They're like, how are we going to sell this thing? All right, let's take a listen.
Yeah.
in London, and you were speaking about research that's being done on dimethyltryptamine.
Yeah.
Can you talk about that?
Well, that's happening at Imperial College. And I recently attended an event just a few weeks ago with several of the volunteers in that project. And what's happening is they are legally being given DMT at Imperial College, which is one of the leading research institutes in the UK. And for the first time ever, they're not looking to find out what are the possible therapeutic outcomes of this. They're actually looking at the experience itself. It's very well known. Anybody who's used DMT, I've used DMT multiple times, is going to have entity encounters. They're going to meet entities who may sometimes look very weird. They may be part animal, part human in form. They may be almost formless, but yet they speak to you, they communicate with you. And of course, the mainstream attitude, this is just rubbish, this is just your brain on drugs. Well, Imperial College, they're now testing that view. And what they're finding is that these and something else, DMT, as I'm sure you know, Joe, is a very short-acting experience when you smoke it. It's about 12 minutes, maybe less. You're in there, you're plunged into a completely convincing, sometimes terrifying, parallel reality. It's so confusing, you hardly know what's going on, and then you're out again. But you come out with a feeling that something's been downloaded to you. In Imperial College, they found a way to keep people in the peak state of DMT for an hour.
Wow.
They're delivering it through drip, through timed release, and they're keeping the volunteers in an hour in that state. So they have time to find their way around the DMT realm that they find themselves in. And the astonishing thing is that these volunteers, both men and women, are all coming back with accounts of meeting the same entities and the same world. And it has to raise the question, and I know Rick Strassman has been on your show. And kudos to Rick Strassman, because he was really the first scientist to work with DMT and human volunteers at the University of New Mexico. Rick Strassman is open to the idea that what happens with DMT is that it alters the receiver wavelength of the brain, and that it allows us to gain access to other realities, that these encounters are not unreal, that they're real, but they're real on a level that we can't experience in a day-to-day state of consciousness. We have to be in an altered state of consciousness in order to experience them. And ultimately, the aim of this project is to map the DMT realm. You know, we talk a lot about extraterrestrials and ETs and making contact, and I'm sure the universe is filled with life, and it would be a very good thing to have the tech to make contact, or perhaps not a good thing, with all those other life forms in the universe. But right there in the DMT experience, inside our own heads, we have the opportunity to encounter another world, another realm, entities who are very different from ourselves and who have teachings to give us. And I think we should be spending a lot more research funds on exploring those experiences and finding out what's going on, rather than zooming off to other planets. Let's do both, but let's make sure that we understand that consciousness is an enormous mystery. Mm-hmm. And at the level of consciousness, DMT opens up literally a parallel world. And there's a nexus here with quantum physics and with the notion of parallel realms and parallel realities. Maybe we can actually access them. Well, the work at Imperial College ultimately is going to come up with some answers on that.
Dude, that's really cool. So isn't DMT the same thing that our brain produces naturally to sleep?
I think melatonin is the thing that naturally created that helps us sleep. But I believe DMT is also naturally produced in the brain.
Yeah, obviously just really small amounts of it.
Yeah. Yeah, and I've heard really cool things about DMT. I've heard really scary things about DMT.
Me too.
And just the way my brain works, you know, I don't want to say I'm a negative guy. I am, I guess. Mm. But I'm so afraid I would get lost in a complete nightmare.
A bad trip.
Yeah.
Yeah, like you said, the smoking one. I mean, it's 12 minutes, but some people, because I watched a documentary called DMT, the something molecule, and there was this mathematician who smoked it, and he said that he went through an entire lifetime as someone else. An entire lifetime. Like, like years and decades, and it was only 12 minutes.
I've heard many stories like that. Actually, now that I remember correctly, I believe DMT is released in the brain upon death. That's the whole you see your life flash before your eyes thing. I was reading an article many years ago, this was in college, about this guy who had been hit by a car. He was on foot, and he died, but he lived out this whole lifestyle where he had gotten married and had kids, and then woke up, you know, he'd been in a coma for a week, and it was an article about, you know, how the DMT had released into his brain or whatever. Mm-hmm. Very, very interesting stuff. But the way
was he upset that he woke up there?
Yeah. He was, because he had no memory of his real life, and he was living whole life as he was dying. It's incredible stuff, the things our brain does.
Man, our reality is so strange. But you know, it'd be boring if it wasn't such a mystery.
Yep, right? And I mean that's why you and I are here. That's why you know we're obsessed with aliens, UFOs, and everything for me, everything of the macabre. That's why I love Lovecraft stuff.
Uncovering anomalies.
Yeah, we love uncovering anomalies.
Podcast. So, do you know the Sean Ryan podcast or show?
I don't believe I do.
He does UFOs also. It's a good show. Well, Tucker Carlson is going to be on there.
Oh,
and apparently they're going to talk about everything: 9/11, CIA, Mockingbird media, UFOs, anti-gravity technology.
Nice. All right.
So cool. That's going to be June 3rd. But here's a quick.
I feel like we're being pushed into civil war.
Yes,
of course. All the lies in the division. I mean,
of course.
Who do you think is pushing it?
I've heard you talk several times on Building 7. So that building got reported being down 26 minutes before it actually fell. And you can't...
Totally normal!
Now, more on the latest building collapse in New York. You might have heard a few moments ago. I was talking about the Salomon...
There's a woman on TV talking, on BBC, talking about...
Oh, I've seen it.
Yeah, talking about how the building is already down, is already collapsed, and it's right behind her.
Jane, what more can you tell us about the Salomon Brothers building and its collapse?
See, behind me, the Trade Center appears to be still...
Let me just 26 see. Minutes later, the building collapsed. What do you
think? Well, first of all, how dare you for noticing? That's the official position of Washington. Shut up.
Yep.
If your answer to a sincere question, like, how did that happen, is shut up, it's to attack me for asking the question, then I know you're rotten. Mm-hmm. I know you're serving evil. I mean, that's the hallmark of it. You're attacking me for asking an obvious question? Really? Because I'm not a slave. I don't work for you. I'm a free man in a supposedly free country. Therefore, I have an inalienable right, which is to say given by God right, to ask obvious questions. I have to give up everything for the sake of this thing. And the disillusionment that I have noticed in men like you, who've really done a lot for this enterprise, and then come to the obvious conclusion that it's not exactly what it seems.
We're trying to get into...
What the hell, man? Why? CIA. Why?
Yeah, it's Vladimir Putin reminded me. I don't know how you knew that. So when I played the CIA... Anyway,
that's going to be a good interview. I mean, he talks about the CIA, 9/11, UFOs. I think he talks
all the good
about
stuff. UFOs.
Yeah, all the good stuff. It's great seeing him become the person he is right now, Tucker. It's really cool.
I'm enjoying this. I did see... God, so stupid. All the... Again, this is on Reddit. All the news articles, subreddits were posting like Tucker Carlson started a channel in Russia and yada, yada, yada. And it kept getting re-messaged and retweeted. And then it got noted on X, and it was like one of Russia's programs was screened in Russia. So like,
oh, God,
not even close to the truth. Like, you know, an international group had just taken one of his interviews and, you know, put it on TV.
I think there's Tucker derangement syndrome. It's just as bad as Trump derangement syndrome.
Oh, Trump derangement system is way worse. I mean, at some point, we're going to have to talk about what happened this week.
Oh, yeah. Yeah. We'll get there. It's so nuts. So I sent you this. You said it comes up many times. I've seen it come up many times also. The Challenger astronauts are allegedly alive.
I mean, I've been seeing this for years, and people have posted some pretty crazy evidence. People have found... people who supposedly died during the Challenger explosions with the same names, and they look like they're just the same people, just aged older. It's bizarre, absolutely
it's
bizarre.
Crazy. And all of them, it's not like one of them.
All of them.
Yeah, and some of them would say, oh, well, I had a twin brother, and that's who that is. So this guy goes in front of the Brevard County Commission to talk about this. He was saying because it's in their jurisdiction or something. That's Kennedy Space Center. So he wanted them to investigate what happened. I got to give it to him, man.
Little backstory. I think we all remember the Challenger explosion that took place in 1986 that tragically took the lives of all seven astronauts on board. It launched not too far from where we're standing here today. Well, the interesting thing is a couple decades later, this thing called the internet came about, and someone allegedly found almost all of those astronauts alive and well, many using the same exact names. As you can see here, we have Challenger astronaut Judith Resnick and also a Judith Resnick Yale law professor. Michael J. Smith, the pilot of the Challenger astronaut and also professor at University of Wisconsin, now retired Michael J. Smith. Commander Dick Scobie, who is now president of Cows and Trees. Now, if you'll notice, they all have the exact same faces 30 some odd years later, the same exact name, and they are the same age. Now, we all have a doppelganger out there, right? No big deal. But to have the same face, the same age, and the same exact name is extremely rare. So rare, I could only find one case in the last 120 years. And we're supposed to believe that three people from one spaceflight have exact lookalikes that have the same age and same exact names. This, ladies and gentlemen, is beyond statistically impossible.
It's bizarre.
Miss Resnick was questioned at Yale by a journalist, and she panicked and ran from the camera. Why? Mr. Michael J. Smith was also questioned, and he said, yeah, we look alike, but that's not me. You can see both of these exchanges in a film called Level With Me, and you can be the judge.
Mr. Sir, I'm going to have to stop.
Sir, this is a public comment.
I know what it is, sir. I'm very familiar with the public comment.
Oh, okay.
And part of the public comment is that you're only allowed to address things that we have jurisdiction over. We have no
jurisdiction. I have a direct request at the end of this that is in your purview, sir, please. I do. Can we hold the time, please? I have a direct request that...
Listen to me very carefully. Mr. Richardson, would you give an opinion in regards to this, please?
Yes, public comment is reserved for issues or topics that are under the jurisdiction or control of the county commission or that are relevant to the business of the county commission. So if your request at the end is going to explain why that falls into any of this, make that request now before you continue.
Absolutely. So as I was saying, I'll just end it with what I was ending with. But the ask is that Ms. Pritchett, who knows very well about questioning science, whether it be COVID or fluoride, I'm just asking you all to question the science here. Your Goodson and Pritchett, your district covers the Kennedy Space Center. This launched from the Kennedy Space Center. You have the ability to help me in sounding the alarm and asking the federal government for help. If this is contained in your area, I should be able to at least address something that happened here. Don't you agree?
That's not within the jurisdiction or authority of the county commission.
Thank you very much.
Will you let me finish?
Anyway, they kick him out.
You're finished.
You're finished. They kick him out.
Yeah, shocker. Yeah.
They weren't too happy with that. Of course, underneath that is a lot of posts about that the moon landing was fake.
Yeah, this is one of those things where I don't know what to think. I mean, it's a hell of a coincidence. If it's a coincidence, maybe it's over exaggerated. I don't know, but for some reason you're not allowed to ask certain questions about certain things.
Right.
You're deemed as an exile in society if you do those things. I mean, it started with JFK. If you asked questions about the JFK assassination, you were an outlier. If you asked questions about 9/11, you're an outlier. If you ask questions of COVID most recently, I mean, thankfully a lot of COVID people have been vindicated, because of all the truths that came out after COVID was over. Over for most. I know there's still some people who are dead set on, like, I keep seeing posts about long COVID and bullshit like that. The funny thing is, especially on Reddit, so someone talks about long COVID, I go, huh, did they get vaccinated? And then they say, oh yeah, of course. Like, well, how do you know it's not the vaccination? And then I inevitably get downvoted and sometimes banned for certain subreddits, but it's fun.
Yeah, so there was someone that posted under there that this interview with the filmmaker, God, I forget his name now, but he was on Rogan, and Gus Grissom was supposedly killed by the CIA. He interviewed his wife and I think his son as well. And
wait, hold on, he was killed in an accident shortly after hanging a lemon on the Apollo spaceship. He hung the lemon to signal that the ship would never make it to the moon. His widow maintained the CIA killed him since he was describing them messing with the equipment the day before his ship was set on fire. accidentally.
Yeah, right. So this guy's great.
That's Grissom. And not only that, I interviewed the widow of Gus Grissom, who was going to be the first man to walk on the moon.
And we should explain one of the things that Gus Grissom did that got people very angry. He hung a lemon.
That's right.
Yeah, explain that.
Well, basically, he was totally confused how they could possibly think they're going to the moon in 2 years. He thought it was at least 10 years away. And still, we can't even go now, right, because of the radiation. And he was preparing reports to give to Congress and the Senate that his wife told me were confiscated from his house by CIA agents before they even informed her that he was dead, which he had died a few minutes earlier. She told me, I interviewed her for 4 hours. This is the man who is going to be the first man to walk on the moon. And he was the most beloved of the press corps. And he was so frustrated, he kept complaining up the chain of command they wouldn't fix anything because the higher-ups knew they weren't going to go and hadn't committed yet to faking it and therefore hadn't told the astronauts yet. And that's why they weren't fixing anything.
This is your belief.
Well, that's her conclusion as well.
Right.
And in his fury, without permission, he held a press conference. He invited in a bunch of reporters to the top of the rocket where he affixed a lemon the size of a grapefruit on a coat hanger. He said, this thing is a lemon, a piece of junk, made the evening news. And a few days later, he dies. His wife told me that on January 26, 1967, he came home from work and said the following. Hun, for some strange reason, the CIA is all over the launch pad today. I wonder why they're here inspecting the equipment. Never seen him here before. He's dead the very next day from faulty equipment. His widow told me he was murdered by the CIA. The man who was going to be the first man to walk on his moon. His son, 747 pilot, said the same thing, who I interviewed for 3 hours, that his father was murdered by the CIA. So it's one thing if they faked the moon landing and didn't kill anybody. Maybe I'll confess my devious nature. I kind of, admire their ingenuity. You know, like the people who tunnel from the dry cleaner into the bank. But not if you kill three guards, slit their throats, who have wives and children. And the first...
What three guards?
Well, I'm just saying, for example, if they faked the moon landing and didn't kill anybody, that's one thing. But that's not the case, you see. And I know the type of person you are and the type of guests you have on your show. We're true patriots. And patriots have to face facts that when people take an oath to this country, it's to protect it against all enemies, foreign and domestic. They always want misdirection, the boogeyman, to be in some other country where the biggest traitors to our country are Americans in high office, right? That's what's going on. And the first document of our country isn't the Constitution. It's the Declaration of Independence, where it says when any government becomes destructive of life, liberty, and the pursuit of happiness, it is the right of the people to alter or abolish it. Where, according to Betty Grissom, they took away his life. They take a third of our income, they deceive us through a moon landing, and then they use that money to pay the salaries of the CIA agents who killed Gus Grissom and two of his friends.
Okay, but let's go to Gus Grissom's death. So Gus Grissom died in an accident. Right. He died in a fire, correct?
His wife says that fire was set intentionally.
I understand that she says that. I understand that, and I understand that why she would believe that. That makes sense.
Well, if her husband says CIA agents are messing around with the equipment the day before and he's dead the next day from faulty equipment, the CIA killed him. It's a pretty obvious conclusion.
It could possibly be that, definitely. But also, when you're launching rockets, a lot of people die.
They weren't launching anything. It was just a ground test of pressing buttons. And they found that they pressurized that space capsule with 100% oxygen, where steel will become flammable. They reversed the door the day before so that it opened inwardly instead of outwardly. It took an extra 5 or 10 minutes to open up. And then they found a pile of oily rags under his seat so that they would do a spark. And then I got the Apollo 1 report. We bought it for $10,000 from Roger Chaffee's widow from his estate. And there was a dip in power right before the fire, because the CIA had clamped in there to start the fire. They ignited it. It caused a dip in power, and then the fire began.
So where is this evidence that there was a dip in power?
Well, it's in the Apollo 1 report.
He's not really good at listening, huh? Man.
No, I mean, that's a standard Joe Rogan interview. I'd never heard of Grissom before this. I had never heard that story about the whole lemon thing. And
I didn't know he did a press conference. I know that he died. It was Gemini, right? Gemini 1 or something.
Well, I mean, the thing says it was on the Apollo ship, though.
Or Apollo 1, then. It was Apollo 1, yeah.
Gemini was before Apollo, if I remember.
Yeah, correctly. So it was Apollo 1, yeah. But I didn't know he did a press conference and this whole lemon thing and the whole CIA where he saw the CIA agents a day before. I mean, I didn't know any of that. I knew he was killed because he was talking, you know, that this thing is not going to happen.
Yeah.
Not in a couple of years.
Interesting stuff.
All these shenanigans.
Lots of shenanigans.
Need some more shenanigans.
Yeah, so I sent this one to you, the Israeli art student mystery. For almost 2 years, hundreds of young Israelis falsely claiming to be art students haunted federal offices, in particular the DEA. No one knows why, and no one seems to want to find out. Well, we know why they don't want to find out. Israel has us by the balls.
Yeah,
They've infiltrated every group of our government and media. Well, I'm not going to, this is not a whole Jews run the world thing rant. I'm just saying there's a lot of offices in our government that
seem to couch
the whole Zionist agenda.
2002, this one was published. Wow.
Oh, I didn't even notice that when I sent that to you.
Yeah, 2002.
Wow.
So now a lot of people link these art students also to the 80th floor on, I forget which tower. But it's basically where the plane hit. And there's pictures of them that looks like there's some TNT that they were putting in there.
Yeah, I mean, there's a lot of, I mean, the more and more, the further and further we get away from 9/11, I'm learning more and more. And there's just so much sketchy stuff that was going on right around there. I mean, you got the guy who took the insurance out on the buildings, Lucky Larry. Is that what they call him?
Yeah, Lucky Larry.
You know, you've got the dancing Israelis. I mean, obviously, the passport stuff. You've got that, the whole, if you look at the Pentagon attack that same day, I mean, none of it adds up. There's just a hole in the side. There's no plane parts, no bodies found. I mean, it's the bodies found, I can kind of get high speed, high impact with a large thing. Sure, the bodies are incinerated, whatever, they're crushed. Right. I get that. But the fact that there's not a seat or a wing or any part of the fuselage lying around is nothing. Building 7, nothing about 9/11 makes any sense. The National Guard was running around doing tests that day.
So yeah, there was like 20 of them. There was 20 different tests, simulations.
Yeah. I mean, just bizarre stuff.
Yeah, and you sent me this. So it's a clip from a 5-hour documentary called Ring of Power, Empire of the City. I definitely recommend watching that.
I was going to say, I hope you link the BitChute video in the
notes. Oh, okay. I'll do that.
Yeah, because I've been meaning to get to that, and I just haven't yet.
Okay, so here, let's play. It's a great documentary. I mean, she goes through everything. I don't know where she gets her information from. It's from 2007. She even links that Moses and a lot of the biblical figures were actually Egyptians, ancient Egyptians. And she links it that way. And then, of course, she goes into Freemasonry. And then she gets into 9/11. Let's watch this one.
How could Muhammad Atta's passport survive the fireball explosion that supposedly cremated him, fly out of his pocket, fly out of the incinerated plane, flutter to the ground in the 2 feet of debris, and end up in readable condition in the hands of investigators, all within 48 hours? Why did 19 Muslim men even need passports on domestic flights? How were passports found but not the plane's voice recorders? Why did the hijackers need passports they would never use again after their suicide flights? And why were the 19 accused Muslims not under surveillance on 911 if they were so easy to identify? The conspicuous trail of planted evidence continued 3 weeks after the 911 attacks, when anthrax letters killed 5 people and were clearly worded to throw the blame on Muslims. Death to America, death to Israel, Allah is great. It has since been proven that the anthrax came from a U.S. Army lab and was never mailed by Muslims. There are no airport security videos of any of the 19 accused Muslims boarding any of the hijacked planes. Right after the 911 attacks, CNN reported that the U.S. government had a tape recording of Osama bin Laden telling his mother that something big was about to happen and that she wouldn't be seeing him for a while. CNN later acknowledged that the report was false. Osama bin Laden consistently denied being involved in 911 and claimed the Israeli Zionists were behind the attacks. According to Japanese, Chinese, and Indian news reports, Osama bin Laden was killed in Afghanistan in the fall of 2001 and was buried in an unmarked grave by his own men. The Muslim world and millions of Europeans, including Germany's former Minister of Technology, Andreas von Bülow, believe that Zionist extremists staged the 9/11 attacks on America to ignite the war on terrorism. That war has targeted Israel's Muslim enemies and is being fought and paid for with the blood, the lives, and the tax dollars of terrorized American citizens.
Sounds familiar. We need to continue there.
pretty wild. Yeah, I'm looking forward to getting through that whole documentary. I mean, there's a lot of stuff jammed in there.
Yeah, so Empire of the City. So she basically says that because she calls it Empire of the City, basically the city of London is it's its own sovereign city, and that's the financial part. Then Washington D.C. also is its own state by itself, and then the Vatican. So yeah, is the army. So D.C. is the army, and then the Vatican is the.
There was another fun article that came out, kind of went under the radar, about the Vatican this week. The Pope had to apologize for using a homosexual slur when referring to, you know, priests who prefer male on male.
He said we need to get rid of it, right?
I don't know what his exact quote was, but he called them the F word, folks, in case you're wondering.
Yeah. The F word, T-R-Y.
Yeah.
So Bell X-Plane progresses under DARPA development program. This is the only picture I could find, though.
That just looks like a, what are they called? I see them at work all the time because we live by, I work by a base.
Oh.
Osprey. Looks like an Osprey, but like futuristic.
Oh, yeah.
It's a VTOL, vertical takeoff and landing.
VTOL, exactly. And that's what this is part of also. This is preliminary design of an experimental aircraft aimed at combining high speed with runway independence to advance air mobility platforms. So, there you go. HSV VTOL. High speed.
Oh, it is high speed. Wow. I mean, it's right there right before that, but I hadn't seen it. And I totally guessed high speed. Awesome. Very cool.
In Holloman Air Force Base.
And if you are a fan of the Fallout TV show or the games, you see planes that look exactly like this.
That's right. Look at that. So cool. Yeah. These aren't drones, right? These people will be in there?
I believe so.
Wow. And then what? It just folds and those become like turboprops.
It just rolls forward. I mean, I've seen Ospreys land and take off. It looks like it starts with like a helicopter formation and then they roll up in front like a World War II plane.
Very cool.
Yeah.
This is from the Giza Death Star. Dr. Joseph Farrell, who's an excellent author on mysteries.
This bill is a bombshell and quite a blow against Mr. Globaloony.
Global Looney.
Poor guy. Change your last name, bud.
Well, I think, no, he's making fun of the globalists. He's calling them Global
Looney. Okay. Woof. I thought that was his actual last name. I didn't get the context of the article. Now I see. Global Looney. Sure. Okay. That makes
he's
like, wow, that is an unfortunate last name.
Yeah, he's always coming up with nicknames. He's really good at that. So apparently Louisiana has nullified the WHO, UN, and WEF.
Yeah, this is obviously a huge backlash just from COVID. Everyone was completely misled and lied to by all of these organizations. And I think there's a huge pushback against you see a lot of the articles. We talked about it last week or the week before, the H5N1 bird flu coming around. And people are just going like, no, we're not doing the skin. You're obviously bringing this up because it's election season. And people are starting to see through the facade.
Yeah. And they use these emergencies to completely nullify the Constitution and get rid of our civil rights. Yeah. You know, just because it's an emergency.
There was a great video on Reddit. It was all of the celebrities that were coming out and posting on X about screw your freedoms and shit like that.
I saw it, never
forget these idiots. You know. Yeah.
They should never be trusted. Seriously, especially that they came out so aggressively. Cuomo had a debate with Dave Smith on the PBD broadcast. It was pretty good, but I'm surprised Cuomo did it. He didn't apologize for anything.
Yeah. He's got nothing to apologize for. I know he resigned or whatever, or got fired. I don't even know. I mean, sexual harassment thing. But at the end of the day, that guy's living in a nice house in a nice part of the country, and he's got nothing to worry about.
No, he doesn't. And you know, he got hired by News Nation, so he's not hurting at all.
Yeah.
So this bill, the text goes, the World Health Organization, United Nations, and the World Economic Forum shall have no jurisdiction or power within the state of Louisiana. No rule, regulation, fee, tax, policy, or mandate of any kind of the World Health Organization, United Nations, and the World Economic Forum shall be enforced or implemented by the state of Louisiana or any agency, department, board, commission, political subdivision, governmental entity of the state, parish, municipality, or any other political entity.
Yeah. Well, the thing is about the WHO, I mean, obviously they lost a lot of credibility with COVID, but all they did was provide
guidance.
They didn't say you have to, because they have no power. They just said, this is what you should do, you know? And so, I mean, I get it, but I get why this is a thing, but I also don't think WHO is like the end all be all bad guy. I mean, I think that rests mostly with Fauci. He's the one in power who actually gets to tell people what to do. The WHO just provides, hey, maybe you should do this, maybe you should do that.
Yeah, same thing with the CDC, by the way. They only recommended. It was everyone else that said, oh no, you have to do it. So once the CDC came out and recommended it, the schools did it, the states did it. They didn't have to. You know, because you cannot force us under our system to do that.
It's just, you know, it's so ridiculous because it's not like I wish this, but like it would have been one thing if the unvaccinated unmasked were falling down dead every day. And it was just like, oh my God, I have to wear a mask. But like people quickly realized like how much of a sham it was.
Yeah, it was not scientific at all. I mean,
you know, and all the lies that came out. If you get vaccinated, you can't get the disease. Lie. If you get vaccinated, you can't transmit the disease. Lie. You know, even if you're perfectly healthy, you're going to die. Lie. I mean, all this stuff.
It was just so bad. It was so bad. And you know, the nighttime shows, they'll be like, what's his name? One of them. He was like, If you're vaccinated, you're having a heart attack, come right in. Oh, you're having a heart attack, you're not vaccinated, sorry, bud. You know, it's like it was a dark time.
It really was. I mean, and we lost so many like good small businesses.
200,000 small businesses shut down forever.
And man, I'm not going to say the name of the company because that will show where I'm at, but they made the best sandwiches. Like I still dream about this sandwich. It was so good, and they closed, and I'm like brokenhearted because I cannot find a sandwich that even matches my favorite sandwich.
Dude, that sucks.
Was it a mom and pop one? It's a bunch of Well, I don't really know. Okay. It's a bunch of stuff that I don't like individually. It was coleslaw, Thousand Island dressing, and what was the meat? Name sandwich meats. Go.
Roast beef, pastrami.
Nope.
Salami.
Keep going. Nope.
Ham.
Keep going. I think it was
turkey.
Was it pastrami? I don't know. Anyway, it was so good.
Pastrami. Yeah.
It was so good. It was so good.
Nothing like a good sandwich, man.
Oh man, you get all your major food groups in there. Not really.
And, you know what I mean. I mean, I like mine toasted and I like squishy. It depends what's in there.
Mm-hmm. See, and this is what I'm talking about. It was perfectly toasted. So you got the sandwich and you had that like little crunch of the bread. Not like enough where it was like toast, but like it wasn't totally soft, so it wouldn't get all soggy.
Yeah.
I don't like coleslaw. I don't like pastrami. I don't like Thousand Island dressing that much. But you put it all together and you get this beautiful.
You're making me hungry.
I know, right? Incredible sandwich. And I still, because we get birthday lunches at work.
Yeah.
So every month the birthday people get to pick out a restaurant to get food from. And we used to get that place all the time and it was fantastic.
Oh yeah. So we talked about this.
So we're getting into this now, are we?
Yes, we are. So Geiger Capitalist, it's got 17 million views. So
this is a great take on it.
Yeah, he goes, the first felony conviction of a former U.S. president wasn't for the Iraq or Afghanistan wars, illegal CIA coups, drone striking weddings, or spying on Americans. It was because Trump misclassified a $130,000 payment for a porn star's NDA. Tells you everything you need to know.
Yeah, I mean, the Democrats at this point are throwing everything they can at Trump. And if, I mean,
it's ruining the country, though. Right?
If Trump were to go full dictator, like, oh, Democrats' wet dream, and he starts jailing people who oppose him, I mean, that's what they want, right? I mean, but that's what they're trying to do to him at this point.
They're projecting.
Yeah, it's absolutely crazy because what I've learned about reading about this case is it's not illegal to make people sign NDAs. It's not illegal to pay people hush money.
Nope. Clinton did it.
I've read stories of, hey, I will pay you to tell me your story, but it has to be exclusively to me. And so you pay the person, they tell you your story, and you just bury it and it goes nowhere. Okay. And they're legally not allowed to tell anyone else that story. All of this stuff is legal. All of the people who are in Congress, former presidents, congressmen, people of the House, people of the Senate, the judges, they all do this. They all pay hush money and all this stuff, but it's true. He was declared guilty in New York City, in Queens, by a judge who was a Democratic. He gives money to Democrats, whatever that's
called. He's an activist too.
Yeah. And everyone with a brain can see that how much of a sham this is. And while I was sitting at the tire shop, my phone died and I was just watching news on TV and they were going through. How many people would change their minds about voting for Trump after this decision? 0%. How many people will not vote for Biden after this? 0%. This changes nothing.
What was the point?
It just gives Trump more fuel to his anti-establishment stance, even though he's not anti-establishment at all.
No.
But my the thing that irks me the most is all these people online or in real life, they're going, and I know several people in real life who say things like this. They talk about how, oh, Trump's going to be a dictator. He wants to take away the rights of gays and black people. And it's like, you guys realize he was president for 4 years, right? Like, what rights did you lose?
None. They just believe the TV, you know?
I even said this to one of my friends. She got super mad at me. Well, this was back when Roe v. Wade was getting overthrown.
Okay.
I was saying, okay, you've got the option for birth control. You've got the option for safe sex, aka condom or IUD or any pills, anything. Mm-hmm. What have you lost with Roe v. Wade overturned? And she just started screaming at me, saying how I was a sex bigot.
Trigger.
And I'm like, but you haven't answered the question. What rights have you lost?
Nothing, because all they did was give it to the states. They said, all right, the states should deal with it. It shouldn't be a federal issue. So if you're in California, you're fine.
The worst part about it is she was trying to have a baby. So it's like, what are you so mad about? You're trying to have a baby. What rights have you lost with this? Nothing.
It's just an emotional
issue. Screaming. I go, I mean, women are not second-class citizens anymore. What can you do? What can you do as a man that you cannot do as a woman?
I mean, there isn't.
I guess you can't. You can't play in the NFL. I don't know how many women are a professional gridiron football at this point.
They don't have a women NFL, do they?
They've got lingerie league, but that's also for men. But I mean, it goes to the Bill Burr bit when he's talking about the WNBA. The WNBA's. They're paid for by the NBA, by the way. I don't know if you knew that. And the majority of people who go watch WNBA games are men. Women don't care about women's sports.
Yeah, and not that many people watch it anyway.
Right.
When they talk about the salaries and stuff, it doesn't get the same numbers. It's a business decision. Salaries are made by profit and revenue.
Exactly. Yeah. I mean, everyone wants to see LeBron James do whatever he's doing. I can't name a WNBA player, but people clearly aren't passionate about it as much as they are, you know, watching.
So it has nothing to do with sex. It's a business decision,
right?
You know, but just to get back to Trump, you know, Congress paid out $17 million of hush money.
Yeah. This is far from the first time a person in governmental power has paid hush money. That's why everyone is scratching their heads trying to figure out how this is a win.
The whole thing that Trump is a victim, right? And that, and by the way, he raised $35 million that day. And that's small amounts. And then after that, also, he had the big donors, so the billionaires, Adelson's wife, you know, Adelson, he put $100 million to Trump before. His wife said she's going to put in hundreds of millions of dollars into his campaign. Bill Ackman, also a billionaire, he said he's going to put in millions of dollars. It did nothing except increase his funding, probably increase his popularity. There's a bunch of independents out there, even Democrats I saw, supposedly Democrats, saying that they're going to vote for him because this is a sham and it should not be happening in this country. We do not go after political opponents. And, you know, it sets a really bad precedent.
Yeah, I mean, it just gives him more. I mean, he literally has this now to fall back on where he gets to go. Yeah. Listen, here I've got a list of everyone who's given hush money to whoever. Here's all the people that have committed crimes while in power and nothing happened to them. I had sex with a porn star and gave her a six-figure payment and they literally, you know, gave me a guilty plea and he can list, you know, here's the judge, here's the jurors, here's where it happened. And obviously he's appealing and it's not going to go anywhere further than this. I mean, it's just such a stupid.
I hope not. Do you think they'll put him in prison?
Dude, if they put him in, if they put him in prison, I straight up think he'll get more votes.
Oh, of course he will. So, okay, how would this look like? All right, say they put him in prison and that he's in jail in the primaries, right? And say people vote for him, he wins. What next? They vote, they swear him, himself. They swear him in jail.
I don't know. That's a really well. They'll find a way to rig it,
and then he'll pardon himself. Oh my God.
Honestly, I don't know. I mean, this country is pretty wild. White collar people rarely go to prison. Trump is rich and influential enough to not go to prison. He'll the worst he'll get is probation.
Yeah. Okay. Well, I hope that's the case. This happened today. And I don't know how true this is. Some people are saying that the Houthis actually, that the USS Eisenhower is, what is it? Not drowning. That they sunk it. I don't believe that. But they targeted the USS Eisenhower aircraft for the second time. Targeting of a U.S. destroyer at the Red Sea. Four operations which targeted ships in the Indian Ocean, the Red Sea, and Arabian Sea. And they're doing this, obviously, to support the Palestinians. But I'm only bringing it up because if they really sunk the Eisenhower, they still don't know what happened to it, by the way. There's no official... Actually, some research.
This is the first I'm hearing about this.
Yeah, it just happened before. How do you spell the Eisenhower like that? Oh, there it is. Ike. They call it Ike. Wonder if there's any news about it, like sinking. A few hours ago. Oh, Ashton. A few hours ago, source contacted me on Signal saying they had heard the USS Eisenhower had been sunk. They spoke to someone they trust with their life and claimed it was confirmed. I was skeptical and looked online and found the reports from the supposed failed attack. Yeah, that ship, man, it is huge.
We do have the biggest navy, right?
Oh yeah, yeah, by far. I think China has.
I know we've got the largest military, that's for sure. Oh wait, is this footage of the attack?
2023. So yeah, there's gonna be a lot of fake stuff, I'm sure. I guess we still don't know. And what's this here? What's this one?
UFO. The music. Boom. Wow.
But that's a smaller ship. It doesn't look like the Eisenhower. Look at that. They have these things, man. What the hell is going on here? It's like they're doing it on purpose. Man, if Trump was in power, you know he'd nuke that country. He's psycho like that.
Yeah. And a huge supporter of Israel.
Oh, yeah.
do you want to vote for the fat, loudmouth Zionist, or do you want to vote for the shitting-his-pants, smells-little-kid Zionist?
Yeah, that's the choice we have in this country. Yeah. Zionist 1, Zionist 2, or Zionist 3, RFK Jr.
Yeah, I was just going to say, as much as I like RFK, it's just like, oh, God.
Douglas McGregor, breaking Yemeni Air Force releases announcement of targeted strikes. All right, so corporate media is denying these claims.
Wow.
It's getting crazy out there.
Here we go.
And it was just
this is great
about Israel.
This is great.
All right, let's take a listen to this guy. I don't know him, but he's pretty funny.
Very funny.
Israel says it's the only democracy in the Middle East, which is fine. That's fine. You just have to complete the sentence, right? The only democracy in the Middle East that gets $4 billion in military aid from the United States every year. The only democracy in the Middle East that uses white phosphorus on civilians. The only democracy in the Middle East that refers to starving trapped population as putting Gazans on a diet. The only democracy in the Middle East that refers to bombing that same population as mowing the lawn. Israel is the only democracy in the Middle East whose soldiers make TikToks of their war crimes. The only democracy in the Middle East. Israel is the biggest fucking Karen in the Middle East, okay? A white woman who moves into someone else's neighborhood, then says she doesn't feel safe and continually calls the police to terrorize the locals, okay? Just a brat with an unlimited murder budget. Dad, I need $14 billion for my ethnostate. The United States is like this drunk, rich, alcoholic dad who's like, all right, be good, don't spend it all at once. What does a Karen do? What does a Karen do when you call her racist? Cry, deflect, and then call you racist. Hey, Israel, stop the genocide. Excuse me? I just had to look at a sticker that said Free Palestine. I think I'm the one being genocided, okay? Why did you bomb this residential apartment building? We dropped flyers on them first. Oh, okay. So you send notes to the people you're about to murder? Like a serial killer? It's not normal. It doesn't make it okay. You've killed everyone here. Okay, but we called them first. Yeah, genocide courtesy calls. It doesn't make you... doesn't make you civilized. Doesn't make the genocide okay. How can you call it genocide when people are still alive? Yeah, it's not genocide after you exterminate everyone. It's genocide when you try, okay? And of course, everything's about October 7th. Everything's about Hamas. Because of course, colonizers' favorite trick is to start the timeline when it's convenient for them. And isn't it wild? Every single time Israel levels a civilian target where they say Hamas is hiding, Hamas manages to magically teleport out of there without a trace. Every church, every mosque, every school, every hospital, Hamas, their tunnels, everything just vanishes. 15,000 tons of bombs all over Gaza, 30,000 people dead. They said they were going to find the biggest Hamas bat cave under Al-Shifa Hospital. And then what happened? Vanished without a trace. Where do they get these superpowers? Who is Israel fighting? Hamas or the fucking X-Men? What's happening? All colonized people see themselves in Palestine. They see some aspect of what was done to them in Palestine. And all colonizers see themselves in Israel. And everything that they're testing now, the weapons, surveillance, counterinsurgency, urban combat tactics, that's all the shit that they're going to export around the world to use against black and brown people. So everything in Palestine,
not just black and brown people,
and is going to happen. It's the past and the future at the same time.
Great, great bit. Funny, yeah. Funny and sad.
Yeah,
which is the peak of comedy.
I mean, that's the best way to get these uncomfortable subjects.
Yeah,
right. Yeah. That's how you can. Because other than that, people are not going to listen. They're just going to ignore you or shut you down.
Exactly.
I mean, the world's changing, dude. It's changing so much. We're seeing all this corruption in all aspects of our lives. You know, people are waking up really quick. And I don't know. It just seems like something is just going to happen. Something, you know, like it just feels like that.
Yeah, you definitely, I definitely have the feel there's something really big on the horizon.
Yeah. That
might just be maybe I'm a sucker and I've lost to the propaganda machine. Very possible, but
I mean, we covered last week, like all those CEOs retiring,
yeah,
again and leaving their companies.
But I mean, it's even more than that. It's just a difference in culture. I mean, so not to make my son like too much of an ass, but you know, when I grew up, And I've been watching South Park since I was a kid, and I recently went back and I was watching some of the episodes from when I was a kid, and like the things they would say, you're not allowed to say anymore.
Oh,
calling
no way.
People, you know, slurs, not that, well, I mean, they had an episode where they talked about the N-word, but calling people, you know, various forms of gay was like, because you'd call, hey, don't be a, you know, you'd say that to your friends. And it wasn't like, I hated gay people. It was just like, that was like a thing you said, but, and now that you're done, you're canceled. If you've mentioned anything like that in your past. I remember growing up, I mean, what was the childhood rhyme? Sticks and stones can break my bones, but words can never hurt me. And that's completely gone out the window, where now words are violence. Silence is violence. Everything is violence. All men are blank. All women are blank. All black people are blank. All white people are blank. I mean, you know, oh, that's a stereotype. That's a really, you know, racist stereotype. But you can't even joke about it anymore.
It's so stupid. It really is.
But you know,
it makes us a weak country.
It does, you know, and you can't say things that you believe anymore. You have to, I mean, I'm
self-censor.
You have to self-censor. Yeah.
Yeah. And, you know, you have to always be tiptoeing around subjects, making sure you're not hurting anyone's feelings. I mean, we've had that on this channel many times where just whole entire episodes are just taken down because, you know, we've said something against whatever it is, vaccines mostly, really.
Mm-hmm.
And if we're calling it misinformation, and other people are demonetized if they say things that are deemed hurtful. It's just words, people. It's opinions.
Yeah, I that's the thing. I don't understand. I mean, me myself, I have the normal childhood vaccines. I'm not against vaccines in general. I had questions about COVID, and for that reason, that makes me some sort of monster, because I have questions that when they're answered, they're not answered correctly, and then
just shut up and take it.
And then the answer changes, you know, after a couple months, and it's like, well, this is why I'm not listening to you in the first place, is because 2 months ago you said the complete opposite.
Yeah. Yeah. And
you know, and
they don't want a population that asks too many questions.
Yeah. So I encourage all of our listeners to ask questions. They say there's no such thing as a stupid question, but truthfully, people, if you ask the wrong question, people will look at you funny, but I do encourage people to ask questions. You're supposed to ask questions.
I'm wondering
human nature.
I mean, I remember growing up, you know, in getting education, they always taught us about critical thinking and how to critically think. Do you think they still do that anymore? No.
I think, that's scary. Well, okay. I think they teach quote unquote critical thinking. Whatever daddy government tells you is the right answer. that is the critical thinking. If you think outside of that box, you're a crazy person or you're stupid.
It's like Jacinda from New Zealand. She's like, don't go to any other websites. Just come to the official government website. We won't have disinformation there. We will tell you the truth. The truth only comes from us. She was something else, that one.
Asterisk, asterisk, asterisk.
Yeah, she was nuts. She was completely nuts.
And then if I remember correctly, she resigned like right after COVID was done.
Yeah.
Right?
Yep. Exactly. Like months into the Ukraine war. I mean, that's what saved us, really. We were still going into the nightmare, and then Ukraine happened, and then all of a sudden the government forgot about COVID and went straight to Ukraine.
Yeah, it goes back to that 80-10-10 thing that every day I believe more and more in.
Oh, you're so right. And it's sad. It's sad because most people, like you said, 80% will just believe any lie someone says.
Yep. Yep.
And they know that. Liars know that. Liars know that 80% of people will just accept it because it just it won't burst their bubble or their
program. Yeah. And we've been conditioned to, and I'm guilty of this as well, something that appeals to our worldview or fits in nicely. Mm-hmm. Oh, hey, here's a new piece of information that fits into what I believe. Perfect. I believe it wholeheartedly.
Yeah, yeah, we all get into that. I mean, I got duped from those videos from China in January of 2020. I was like, oh my god, I got myself a gas mask. I'm not kidding. Like,
yeah, no, dude, I'm right there with you because I was right there.
They're falling over. I'm like, oh shit, what's happening?
All those videos of Chinese people falling over and dying in the streets. I remember coming home. That's when I was living with you know her. I'm not gonna say.
Yeah,
who.
Yeah, yeah.
Yeah, and she was like constantly having friends over, and I was mad, and I was like, "We're all gonna fucking die!" And it was like a month or two after that, I was like, "Okay, this is not as big a deal as I made it out to be."
Exactly, me too. By March, by the time it came here, I was like, "Oh, this is nothing. What's happening now?" Then I started really questioning it.
Yeah, exactly.
But it's crazy, the levels of propaganda, you know?
Yeah, half of it was just me wanting a zombie apocalypse, I think.
Yeah, we're always looking for that. We that's how we want the apocalypse to be, like one big event, you know, not this drawn out slow.
And I honestly think a zombie apocalypse would be super easy. Like okay, I'm not talking about 28 days later zombies. I'm talking like the slow shuffling, think zombies. That's fun.
Or I Am Legend. Those guys are scary.
They weren't zombies. They were vampires. You have to read the book. Ah. Actually, it's very I Am Legend. The whole story, they kind of copped out in the movie with Will Smith. The book is really interesting. The whole reason he's a legend is because all these people who had turned into vampires were terrified of him because he was killing them one by one because he was trying to survive thinking they were trying to kill him, but he was in turn killing them. And I think at the end of the book, he gets captured and he realizes, oh God, this is a society of new people. And I've been their monster this whole time. It's a really cool twist.
Whoa, that is really cool.
Yeah.
So part two is supposed to come out.
Yeah, well, I hope
A remake or something.
The Will Smith, the original, the theatrical ending was the wrong one. The alternate ending was the right one, where he essentially realizes that they are a society and not just mindless monsters.
Yeah, so the alternative one, or the real one, I mean, he sees her, right? She becomes alive or something, and then he connects with her or something?
Well, what happens is, if I remember correctly, it's been a year since I've seen that movie, where he realizes that the monsters are attacking him is because he's captured, like, the lead monster's
queen. Has her.
Yeah. And he goes, oh, okay, I figured it out. I'll just give this queen to you, and you'll let me go, because you're just after her. And it's a nonverbal agreement. And he just walks out of there with the mom and the kid.
Yep.
And that's when he realizes, like, oh God, these aren't monsters. They're just a different type of civilization, which is closer to how the book works.
Oh, okay. And that's much cooler.
Yeah, way, way cooler.
Yeah.
Yeah. It was a good movie. I really liked it.
Do you have any other? Oh, I downloaded, I downloaded the update for PS5 for Fallout. And I reset it. But this is good now, because I went into the mods finally, and it said the one I wanted said, oh, you'd probably have to reset the game. So perfect. I downloaded the PS5 version now, so I'm going to put a mod and I'll start over again.
Yeah, there you go.
But with the mod this time, yeah.
You can do more than one mod. You've got a ton of room on there.
Oh, you can do more than one?
Oh, yes. Yeah, you can do a ton. Just about the file size of the mod, you can see how much room you've got in your PS5 in the top right corner, I think, when you're looking at the mods. I'm in the middle of Fallout 4 again. I've been switching my time between Fallout 4 and Starfield. Fun games. But yeah, actually, I've been reading the Expanse books for the umpteenth time. It's my comfort book series.
Cool.
And watching the TV show. I highly recommend both.
I did start The Expanse, and I don't know why I didn't finish. I did like it. It was just very realistic.
Yeah, it's a realistic take on sci-fi. Yeah. It's not Star Wars at all. It's hard sci-fi where there's actual science behind how the ships work, how machine guns work, how long space travel takes, how long it takes to send a message through space. All of it is super realistic. It's a lot of fun. Highly recommend it. It's a great show, great cast. And the books, that's the thing about the books and the show follows the books pretty closely. I mean, some of the characters have been combined in the books to make the TV show character, as TV shows and movies are known to do, but it stays pretty loyal to the flow of the books. Obviously, I prefer the books because there's a lot more meat in the sandwich.
Yep. And they build it's building up the characters too. I'm sure they have right? And that it makes you empathize more with the characters. It tells more about them, their past, probably what made them what they are. Which is really hard to do on film.
And it does a really good job of the way the books are written. Each chapter is told from the perspective of one of the main characters, and I think that's a really cool way to do it, because you get to see an event from two different angles sometimes. And that's a really fun way to approach a book, because they each have their own opinions of what's going on and their own motivations as to how to approach the situation. Really well written. If you didn't know, The Expanse is written by two authors, but they both work together and use the pseudonym James S.A. Corey. And the way they cut their teeth was they were co-writers with George R.R. Martin.
Really?
Who wrote Game of Thrones.
Yeah. Yeah. No. Okay.
Yeah.
That's awesome.
Yeah. Very,
cool. How many seasons?
There are six seasons of the TV show. There are nine books in total. The TV show cuts off after book six, but there's a reason for that. I'm not going to won't spoil anything.
Okay.
I think eventually it'll come back. There's a whole reason for it.
Okay.
But yeah, the books are a really fun read. I highly recommend the books, The Expanse. Just some of the best characters I've ever seen in a book and in a TV show, quite frankly. And even
I got an Audible, Behind the Flying Saucers by Scully. Is it Frank Scully? Yeah. Really cool stuff in there. He talks about the Aztec UFO crash, Roswell. Is Roswell in there? Or is it just Aztec? Might be just Aztec.
Even still, I mean,
ancient. I love those books in the 50s.
Ancient UFOs, very cool subject.
Yeah, yeah, it is.
All right. Well, we want to thank you all so much for listening to episode 74 of the UAP podcast. That is I Want to Believe Adam. And he will tell us where to find us on social media.
Sorry, I messed up there. Yes. So you can find us on X. We're only on X. Maybe we should branch out, but it just takes way more work. But we're on X. You can interact with us there. You can tag us. If there's anything you want us to cover, we'll cover here on the show, as you can see. Our handle is UAP the podcast. And we are on all podcasting platforms. Apple, Google right now, I think is YouTube Music. iHeartRadio, all of them. I mean, there's too many to mention. And then we're on video platforms on YouTube, Rumble, BitChute, and Odyssey.
And Spotify, you can also watch this podcast on Spotify.
That is our main one. And actually, if you do watch us on Spotify, it is a video. It's not audio.
You can also listen to it audio, just to be clear. If you just want if you don't care about the video part, you can also just listen to it.
Okay, so they give you an option.
Yeah. And of course, and as always, please, please, please reach out with any feedback and let us know how we're doing, any topics you want us to discuss. If you have been abducted by aliens, please let me know. I want to hear all about it. Even if you have a story and it's totally fake, I want to hear it, but that's not true. Make it real.
I mean, we'll bring you on the show.
Absolutely.
You know,
we'll interview you.
Yeah, and see what's going on.
We actually have experience in the whole interview format.
Yeah, and as you can see, we're anonymous, so we'll keep you anonymous as well.
If you want. We can totally...
It will be strange if someone has their real face on there and we don't you think?
We can shout out your full name, your home address, your social security number, your mother's maiden name. We can do all that if you want.
Yes, that's what the aliens want.
Anyway, I am Topher 2000, which if you've watched Terminator, none of them talk like that. In fact, very few of them talk, except for
none of them do. They all speak like Arnold. Well, no, not really.
I think Arnold just speaks like Arnold.
Yeah, yeah.
Screw your freedoms.
That bastard, man. I can't believe he said that.
Fuck that guy.
I cannot believe it. Screw your freedom. Screw your freedom that made me $200 million. Come on, man.
Anyway, we want to thank you all so much for listening. Yes. And we will see you all next week.
Yes, next week.